Show up and set in my super suit and be like, what are we doing?
That guy hits that guy. Pow. Oh, yeah.
So this is 10 years of comics.
What?
We're going to check out some comics of our own right now. So we'll dive into some stuff. Let's check them out.
Let's do it.
Hey, everybody.
Jesus Christ.
It is Wednesday. Wow. That was the reaction I wanted from Riley and Makuga. Woke them up out of their slumber.
Thank you, Roxy. Thank you.
Welcome back to Collider Live. One and all, we are a day away from heading on out to Star Wars Celebration.
It's this Kristian steps on my
I'm not
cord.
Stepping on
I know that. I've been like holding it up, but my I like get tired of just like winging it around my finger the whole show.
Yeah.
I need to like a piece of duct tape right here to.
Oh, you mean this isn't up to standards for most people? This office? What are you talking about?
Let's use the duct tape that's holding together this table here. Yeah. Put it right here.
We're a day away, ladies and gentlemen, for everybody heading out to Chicago. Pretty excited. Roxy Schreier is here. What are you giggling about?
I just know it's going to be a weird one.
What, the trip? Oh,
no,
today.
The trip also, but just there's something in the air and it's weird.
Is it the microphone?
It could be, honestly. It might be the mic. It might be me.
Oh, yeah? Why, you stink today?
I don't know. I can, like, I've got a different lotion on.
A lotion?
A different lotion.
Approach the lotion.
You're really trying to turn into a Brit, aren't you?
I've got a different lotion on.
A lotion on?
Oh, what's this lotion?
Oh, cheerio.
Every Brit that
you
we...
get it in your flat.
Thank you so much. I went to theater school.
Oh, yeah, John Roke is in the hall. What's going on, John?
Hello, everyone.
How you doing?
As an avid watcher now of British TV, that was a very good accent.
I really appreciate that. Those $200,000 that I spent on my drama program really paid up. I could do that moment.
You got it. It all led up to this.
It's great we jammed John in here after being out sick for 2 days. We're in the death box.
We're in the death box.
As we get on a plane
tomorrow.
No, a few years ago, I got walking pneumonia, and ever since then, my lungs are susceptible to bronchitis. So whenever I get sick, if it creeps into my lungs, it's immediately bronchitis. And last year I got really sick. I don't remember. I was out 2-3 days. I had to get shots in my ass, antibiotic shots in my ass. And I was like, I'm not doing that again. So I took a day, thought it'd be better. No, it actually got worse. So I went right to the doctor, got a Z-Pack.
Better now.
So I'm better today. We'll see how I feel at 3 o'clock.
Say that again, Digital Roka.
And I want your ass.
Why do they do shots in the ass?
Does that make a difference?
It goes faster through your system. From where it's at through your, like,
you have the most, like, small vein things going through your butt than anywhere else in your body.
There you go.
Candy ass!
He wants a bunch of candy.
Plus, you have the most fat in your butt, usually.
Yeah.
Thanks,
and
Josh.
You can put it in there, and it spreads through fat.
There you go.
I'm working on it, Josh.
Well, congratulations. I'm glad.
Beat that ass.
He's going to beat that ass. Well, you got healthy because you got a show tomorrow night.
Yeah, I got a show, Top 10 Live.
Sold out yet or what?
First show's almost sold out. We're like 4 away.
Yes.
Second show about 10, 12 away. And then we're going to open up the, for an extra 20 tickets, we're going to open up the standing room only up top for both shows there at reggieslive.com. Or Reggie's Live in Chicago. So go get your
what
tickets.
What a weekend.
Come
what
stand
weekend.
In.
Damn. Top 10. And crazy. You got 4 Center tomorrow night also.
You going to go support them?
Unfortunately, no.
Yeah, he can't.
No, only because...
He would come, though. I know you've come.
I would. Because tomorrow night, myself, Mark, and Ben Bateman, we're going to be doing WGN Radio tomorrow night.
Yeah. Riley?
Yeah.
Yes. So we got someone reached out to us about the Athenaeum Theater where we're performing at. Apparently, it's very hard to sell that theater out. We're at 960 seats. I think there's like 10 seats left or something, too. So they were like, how and what is this? Like, how did they do this? And so they wanted us in there.
They reached out to you guys just based off
that. Adam Witt, who is part of the movie guys, the team that just competed, he's friends with Justin, I believe, is the host. And he was they started kind of going back and forth and looking at it. He told them about the Athenaeum. He's like, wait, what? They sold the theater out? Or they came close to it? It's like, let's talk to these. Well, what is this? And they saw previews and promos and they want to talk about it. So it'll probably be sold out by the time we get there. But it's not really about trying to sell the tickets out. It's about getting
spreading more
of the word out to get to Chicago because it's going to be crazy.
And is it a live stream thing also, Kristian?
What? The live stream, thank you for bringing that up. Actually, the live stream tickets are available. They went on sale yesterday. So if you want to watch the live stream of the match. It is the schmodownlive.com. Go on over there. You can get tickets today. You can get them before they go live, and then it'll be available for another 24 hours afterwards. Or if you're part of the $10 patron, if you're a $10 patron, you just get it automatically.
What you should tell the people at WGN Radio that your crowd warm up and competitor is the movios for WGN America.
I will. Yes. Yeah. I will, actually. Yeah, I will. Absolutely.
Keep it in the family.
Yeah. Small
yeah, yeah, yeah. So we're excited to do that. And that's Saturday
what time?
Night. I think it's Thursday night we're doing the radio. I think it's around 8 o'clock. What time's your show?
6:30 and then 7 and then 10. So, yeah.
So we might be able to make one of those shows on the way back.
If you feel like it.
But anyway, we're going to be there on Thursday night. Friday night is the big Mark Ellis live with these two characters. Mm-hmm. Josh and Ken are going to be hosting both shows, both sold out. And it's going to be a lot of fun.
Which one should I go to?
I'm going to 7.
I know, but I feel that's the thing. I want to go when you're going, but I feel like 10 is cooler. Yeah.
So I think
both sold out.
I think Mark and I were talking about obviously the 7 will be a little more controlled, where the 10:30 will be a little more drunk.
Yeah,
cooler.
Yeah, cooler. knowing Chicago and having been there a bunch of times, that gets rowdy on Friday nights. I like most major cities, but Chicago loves drinking, and so do I. There's the meet and greet is in between the 7 and the 10:30, right. So there's going to be like that hubbub going through, and I feel like a lot of the 7 o'clock people are going to want to try and stick around for the 10:30, and they're that's a lot of time between 7 and 10:30, right. And that's a big show. I mean, we're going to be there from like 6 to 1,
right? That's why I don't want to be contained from 10:30 to 1.
Yeah, that's a tough one.
I don't want to be contained. I want to be able to go out. I want to see the show, hang out, and then...
Where are you going to go, though, when all your friends are there?
Oh, because I can't go anywhere without my friends?
Are you going to go by yourself?
There'll be other people that will... I'm telling you, nobody's going to want to be contained at 10:30. And you think you will, but you're not going to want to be. You're going to want to be out at 10:30. Not these guys, obviously, going to be performing, but like... I'm going to 7, going to enjoy myself, enjoy the show.
Yeah.
Bullshit.
I want to do 7.
I mean, you've never been to Chicago.
Oh, you're going to 7 also?
I'll probably do the 7, and then I want to get a good night's sleep. Because,
Because Saturday.
Saturday.
Yeah.
Saturday, I have, there's something I have to do on Saturday.
What is it? Lose?
Kick Odd Couple's ass.
He's ready.
Let's talk about this, though, too. We haven't really talked about it. So, Roxy, this is a big match for the Odd Couple.
How you feeling?
And Draco and Snyder. Okay. And Draco and Snyder. Look at
Sleep in the hallway.
Yeah. And Draco and Snyder are gonna. This is a big match for them. 3-1. If they get it, if they beat these guys, they go and play the Shire Wolves, which is not an easy task. But if they win on Saturday, this is your biggest match as a manager.
Can we give spoilers yet about the free for all?
Yeah.
Okay. I think it was really reassuring for me watching what Ben did on stage there and what Draco and Snyder did on stage there.
Wow.
And Riley.
Yeah. And I like him better because he's in the room.
But you don't have to take a shot.
So yeah, you got to take the shot. I think that was exhibit C of why I'm feeling pretty good going.
So
they did good. They did good,
Yeah.
And I respect them. It was nice to take out Draco with me. On the way out,
he did take him out with him.
Yeah. So that was nice.
Yeah,
so
Snyder,
I got
Snyder
a little feel.
A lot longer than that.
Yeah, I got a feel for an Draco.
He did. Look at Roxy.
He did.
Yeah. He did.
And I was really proud of them and impressed by them. And I just think you guys are spending a lot of late nights on the phone, like two teenage boys just wanting to have fun.
Wow.
And
you didn't know where you were going with that.
I
remember the teenage girl comment that I didn't like, so I on purpose switched to boys.
I fucking love how into it Roxy is now.
Wow.
Because she is in it.
My boys are the best.
Yeah.
Like, and I'm obsessed with them.
Yeah.
We've been
and
having
think
some
this is,
fun.
You think this is a no-brainer?
I think that... I think that this is a tough competition. I will give you guys that. Absolutely. You guys are really strong. If it was a no-brainer, it wouldn't be as fun.
Right. But you think they're going to pull it out.
Yeah.
Here's what I recommend,
Riley.
Yeah, I
definitely do.
Put 70s movies and Marvel movies on
and
the
Star Wars.
And Star Wars. But Marvel movies because of how Snyder broke yesterday on Movie Talk crying about the MCU. So, like... Put those movies on. He refused to answer. Put 70s on, which he tanked with Bibi.
Yeah,
Daniel.
There's some holes there that we are very aware of.
He's a passionate man. He cries of passion.
All right. Yeah. Well, look.
I can't fault him for that.
You're going to be seeing that. You're going to see. Josh McCuga's going to be busy this weekend because he's not only hosting the Mark Ellis shows, he's going to be doing the pre-warm-up show for the Schmodown on Saturday with Frankie Numbers.
Yeah.
I've got
my suit ready to go. I'm psyched.
What are you going to wear?
No, I didn't tell you. But Brian, by the way,
spoiler.
if you want to see any of this stuff too, by the way, like I said, get the live stream.
Yeah. What are you gonna do? You wait for the fans. Come on, Roxy.
What at the end?
I didn't
know.
I didn't know.
Who dies at the end of Endgame?
You know I like my outfits.
Uh huh. Good for you. No, yeah.
I gotta be honest. A lot of times, I don't think it was an unfair question.
Yeah, no, I really, it really does feel that way now.
I'm on your side on this one.
Ask him again, but use your English accent, and then he'll probably answer.
What are you gonna wear?
There it is.
Perhaps I'll wear it's a light suit with some straps in it.
Right.
Is it hanging in your flat?
We have no more English fans. They all dropped. No left.
All right, guys. Sorry, Jack.
So
you better listen, Jack.
Yeah, the great Brian Ward, who does all the artwork for. He does all the artwork for the Schmodown. He's an amazing artist. If you haven't checked out his stuff, you should. Anything that you see Schmodown related, he's done. The logos, the posters, a lot of the shirts. He's going to be at Star Wars Celebration. Mm. And he's actually – so remember some of these great posters that he made back in the day of what he was promoting two fights?
That's not his.
No, that's not his. But he did the one that I have when Riley and Roka played each other for the third time, and there's that picture of – Riley is Superman when he's doing the Superman punch. He's got these prints of those great posters, and I forget how many he's bringing, like six, but they're like framed, and he's gonna give away all six of them at the pre-show.
Oh, cool. No, wow.
Yeah. So I want him to sign them too because he's brilliant, that guy. Yeah. But anyway, so
is that a point? Is he not usually sign them?
Well, no, he doesn't live in L.A., so a lot of times when he makes them, he sends them, and we just print them out. But for the fact that he's gonna be there,
he lives in the Midwest.
He does. So you know what I think would be great, though, is if – because Riley and Roka will at least be in Chicago. So maybe – because Roka's not going to be there for the Schmodown, but we can have him sign that poster, which would be cool, too. Yeah. Roka, there's no way you can stay, huh?
When are you leaving? What was that?
Oh, no, wait, nice to see you. No way you can stay?
Welcome. I don't know. It depends on the flight. I was trying to change the flight, and the flight was like an extra $200 to change it to Sunday. So.
All right.
A lot of money.
He's leaving before the.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah. I wasn't coming in for the Schmodown because I'm not competing or anything. No one asked me to do anything for it. So
No. He's not. He legit isn't going
to be. I didn't know this. I didn't. No. Didn't ask me to do anything. No, it's
not.
He's
not going
to
magically appear in like a post-credit scene or something.
Yeah. Right. Exactly.
Because there's always a bit at the end.
I can tell you the suit I'll be wearing though, Rox.
I'm telling you guys, day of change flight. That's what you do. Day of change flight.
So you should be saying Saturday morning I should change my flight to Sunday.
Within 24 hours, these airlines, they don't tell you about it. It's like the best kept secret.
Okay.
It's like $50 to $75 for changing your flight day of within 24 hours. If I can make that happen.
All right.
It's a thing.
What airline are you flying?
Well, Delta there, American back.
Ooh, American's tough.
Definitely American has a day of change fee.
We'll see if I can stay in the place that I'm staying at, too, an extra night.
Well, that one I can help you out with.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
I'm not staying with anybody, though.
Never mind.
Yeah, exactly.
Sorry.
I like to stay on my own.
Well, then, F you.
I feel you.
Oh, good.
Thank you, Mr.
Bell. I've never been the dude that has been like, I need my own room.
I'm not saying that. No, I'm just saying for this time.
Listen, I mean, normally, there are a lot of people I know that demand it.
Most?
Yeah, sure.
He's crazy about it, Josh. Really, I'm not even joking. He's crazy about it.
No, I remember the Comic-Con thing. He was such a bastard about it. He's like, I'm a grown man. I'm a grown man. I can't share a room with someone else. I'm like, dude, I was sharing rooms with motherfuckers for the longest time. Share a room.
Ken and I shared the same bed in Seattle. And it was hilarious.
It's awesome.
It's like the stories you tell people.
I'm 50-50. It depends on who it is. It just completely depends on who it is.
I agree 100%.
If it's somebody that's your homie, and they need a place to stay, 1,000% you share it. But if it's
at this
like,
point, half the people I'm going with are my homies.
Yeah,
that's
what
I'm saying.
But also, like, I think that there's of the people that are going to Chicago, there'd probably be one or two of them when you were like, I really hope I'm not assigned to that room. Like,
I wouldn't stay with Snyder, that's for sure.
You wouldn't?
No.
Why?
He's a sloppy son of a bitch.
Is he really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
He's a sloppy son of a bitch.
Is he a sloppy son of a bitch? I didn't know he was sloppy.
He's not dinking deuces in the corner and making you smell it. I mean, like, he's a sock
somewhere. You don't know
that.
I
do know that.
Oh, you stayed with him?
Us Jews do weird things.
The funny thing is I was going to have him and Bateman room, and Bateman was like, I got to get my own room. Plus the fact that they're competing against each other. And I told Snyder that Bateman was out. And Snyder's like, that was a good move because I was going to make that kid's life miserable.
Yeah. He loves
doing it. He was really concerned about it before. He was like, I can't be sleeping with the enemy.
I know.
I can't be sleeping with the enemy.
Snyder loved it because Snyder said he was going to. And so does Snyder because Snyder was going to do head games all
weekend
long.
Oh, he loves
to
good at head games.
Yeah, I kind of wish that was.
He really is.
That's a reality show. That's a Patreon bonus for Schmodown fans. Head like, games. Hey, with Jeff Snyder in the same hotel room with Ben Bateman for a weekend.
Snyder's one of the best at the head games for sure. There's no doubt about it because like, he plays it in the game.
You don't know what's happening.
A creepy GoPro.
You just don't know what's happening. When he's messing with you, it's actually confusing.
Right.
Because I don't know if he knows what's happening.
He loves to do it, though. He's the king of it.
And the frustrating part is he doesn't care if he wins or loses the match.
No.
Most of the time.
He just likes to mess
with you. So he just likes to mess with you. Like before free for all, and I was getting psyched, he walks right up to me, just like standing in front of me. Just standing in front of me like a son of a bitch for like 10 minutes just staring at me, wouldn't let me focus in.
Oh, yeah. That's why I can't wait to see what he does with you guys.
That's why I think Jeff Snyder is my favorite person in the Schmodown. He and JT are my favorite people because JT takes it seriously, but they were on that team for a while. But they have a good time. They entertain. Because, you know me, I don't care if I win or lose, but I just want to entertain. I want people to have
anymore.
A good time.
There was a stretch where you were trying to win.
Sure.
I mean, yeah, but then I realize that everybody's way better than me because they study and all this.
I think that Kristian, what you need to do though is start
dance.
Having these having these moments clipped out for when Josh, although he's not as guilty of it, but when Roka, when Riley, when any competitor says like, "I'm just here to have a good time," so that you can play it back to them anytime that somebody
Roka
goes,
stomp our feet, yell, scream over question.
Kristian, have I ever said that?
Yeah, no.
Thank you.
Roka doesn't say that.
I don't know who's gonna Roka say
it. Riley
Roka
said.
Roka before free for all. I just want to make one round.
Oh yeah, that's for sure.
That's
free for all.
I just want to make one.
Free for all is not a full straight up competition.
But then,
no, but you know what happens.
Right. Good point, Roxy.
But this is the fair thing.
Once you get that one round,
but no, it wasn't just that. This is the fair thing with Roka, and I can't remember who said it. It was just like. It was on Schmodown Rundown. They were interviewing Dan Merle. And just like, once again, it's like Merle said, he just keeps finding himself in these situations where these crazy calls happen. Because it's never like just cut and dry. It's like, there could be an argument made on his side that he got eliminated because what was the heist in Reservoir Dogs? And the answer was diamonds, right? He said jewels, to which you can argue that jewels are diamonds, you know, and that it was ruled against him. And so he lost it. He got pissed off and he took off.
Because I couldn't take Bateman out.
Ears? Yeah, right. And Bateman took you out again. So that was that was
son
the thing.
Of a bitch.
So it was
I'm not saying that especially I've never seen Josh ever actually go or Riley go to that level, but you never know. And the people that I would never expect to freak out sometimes do so. I think we should just start
unless it's a bad boys 2 question. Unless it's a bad boys 2 question and the question is so off the wall and I somehow get it just
you two are going to be competing in each other pretty soon here in the team.
Yeah.
So let's not do freak out to them. We'll find out if that's true.
I don't know.
Josh
something's...
and I are naturally competitive, I think. With each other, so it's fun to go back.
But you know, something happened yesterday as I was going through the Facebook group. This guy, this Matthew Reed guy, is that his name? Matthew Reed?
Mm-hmm.
He's
the rapper.
You mean the new Thrawn?
Dude, this guy is unbelievable.
Don't insult Thrawn. Like, Thrawn's not a rapper. Thrawn's a rapper?
You mean David B.
David B.
Yeah, this guy,
they're all good in their own right.
Listen, his turnaround is ridiculous, Josh. You're gonna love this one.
Okay.
You will like this one. Play it, Cody. This is from last night.
Oh, shit.
Listen.
Oh God.
Yeah.
Good freeze frame.
Yeah.
I walked in, that's when I saw her. She turned my whole life into a cosmic blur. I say, hey girl, one day at the mess. Play a motherfucker, eat your fucking mess.
Ooh.
This one like makes me feel jittery.
Yeah,
I'm not a fan.
Wait till he raps at the end.
This is like from a Terry Gilliam movie.
He does the rap he does at the end.
Who's Terry Gilliam?
But like when
what?
What?
Yeah, well, don't.
You know I don't know directors.
Hold on.
Name a movie
Monty
and then say
Python
that
he's in
Monty
Python.
Monty Python.
Brazil.
Yeah.
Sure.
He does. You like the rap part of it, Macoos.
It's too much.
Yeah,
it's going. Wait, just wait till the rap part comes up. Give the guy a break.
Young man, don't do no drugs.
I'll give you the rap.
Yeah, the rap part of it was good.
Yeah.
There's a lot going on in the beginning. He was trying
there's a lot going on. Yeah.
He was trying to pay homage to the actual lyrics in the beginning.
Yeah.
But when
when he hit
his rap,
he's really good.
Yeah.
Speaking of homage, one of those questions I should ask you guys off air, but I'm just gonna do it now because I'm starting talking.
Great.
How come some people say homage?
I've never heard that, and
it depends on where it is in the like inflection. If it's a single word, it's homage. You pay homage, or it's homage.
Mm.
There are certain inflections of the word and certain uses within a sentence when you say homage
or
homage.
So I always say homage. That's wrong.
Yes, correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
homage is wrong.
When am I supposed to say
homage is correct and homage is correct? It's like
what
I
do you
pay
say?
Homage or homage. It's an homage to somebody.
Homage is right.
But I'm supposed to be using homage at points.
At points, yes. Kind of depends on where you put it in the sentence.
Okay, I never use that one.
Wow.
Like the company Homage, who like makes this is 412. Sorry, but a lot of the shirts I wear is a company called Homage. Right? H-O-A-M-E-G.
Well, that's
same
a company
word.
Name, right?
It's a company name, but they are paying homage to the stars and sports and whatever of the past.
Look at this.
Right?
So they're not paying homage.
No, you don't pay homage.
Oh, you pay homage.
You pay homage. Like
it's an homage.
It's like I just made a song called Ba 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 as an homage to Christians, Ryan and Jesus.
I feel like I should be paying you for teaching us that lesson.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Boom. I'll tell you who should be paying us. Last night for the first time. Since I forget when the first record was set, but in 35 years of Jeopardy history, somebody scored over 100,000 points.
Oh, yeah.
Made $100,000, $110,000, broke the all-time record in one round.
Is that Brad? No,
it was this new guy. He's a professional sports gambler from Vegas.
Wow.
He's won four straight. He goes into the daily doubles and goes whatever. So he was at like 71,000, and the all-time record is 76,000 that a guy set way back when, I think in like the late 80s.
That was 76,000 was the record?
Was the record, and he made $110,000.
So is this going to be one of those things that we see in the YouTube videos of what's the guy's name?
His name is James Delavanzo.
Are we going to see like a YouTube video on how James Delavanzo cheated or something?
I don't think so. He's just very quick on the buzzer. He knows everything. He bets big and he just blows people out of the water. And even Alex Trebek said last night, and Alex Trebek in his classic way, who doesn't get excited, he's like, all-time record. All right.
Best that we've ever seen?
Best. He's like, we could be looking at a Ken Jennings situation because all four of his games haven't been just runaways. He's destroyed people.
What's a Ken Jennings situation?
Ken Jennings won 76 games in a row.
Whoa. Wow.
Jesus.
77.
That's the record.
And that's by far the record. The only person close to that is at like 25.
Oof.
But the only person that's...
The game works where if you win, you keep playing.
You keep playing. Yeah. And so... and that used to be if you won five in a row, like back in the days, I think it changed during the mid-90s. If you won five in a row, you were done and you won a car.
Yeah, you retired.
Right? You retired and then you made it to the Tournament of Champions.
Yeah.
Ken Jennings, when they got rid of that rule, Ken Jennings was the first one to really like exploit that rule. There have been people before him that won like 15 or 14 or even 20. The girl Julia Collins, I think, won 21. But Ken Jennings won 77 in a row. He made like $1.8 million. But this guy has made $220,000 in 4 days.
My Lord.
All-time four-day record.
Do you think they should be allowed to keep playing?
Definitely.
Wow.
Why not? Yeah.
The champion's on the top of the mountain. You got to take him out. And this guy is like...
Is he a genius or is he just... Or is he just studies?
He seems like a savant.
Really?
Like when he answers, he's very geniusly awkward, right?
How old is he?
He seems to be like his mid to late 30s. And he's a professional sports gambler from Vegas. He makes gambling references all the time. He makes weird wagers, but he is absolutely destroying people. Like the two people that were on it, had he not been on it, they would have played a pretty good game.
Really? Is he the Michael Jordan of Jeopardy? So, or Jennings?
Jennings is the Michael Jordan. Right now, this guy is a rookie that is just blowing the league away.
Wow.
Yeah. Watching him last night, Amanda was even like, what is happening? This guy is so much better than
him. Do you watch every day?
Yeah.
Just keep it on the DVR?
Yeah.
So he doesn't miss.
He didn't answer two questions and missed one yesterday.
Damn.
And then the other ones that were rung in.
So you're saying Bibbiani's better than him.
Bibbiani. I mean, if this was a movie trivia showdown,
he's the Bibbiani of
the free for all. Will Bibbiani.
If they're on 1 point questions.
Sure. Speaking of which, and I don't want to go back to Shmoda. I don't want to go back to Shmoda too much, but do have a big match though with Roca, Bibbiani, and Irwin that drops Friday before we leave. Winner of that match plays Merle for the title. So just wanted to drop that on the Shmodown channel.
Hey guys,
three of the
basketball time.
Hate to interrupt the show, but we have some breaking news here.
What happened?
Oh.
guys.
Tickets
for Detective Pikachu are on sale. Advanced tickets. I'm buying 151 myself.
There's a Venusaur, there's an Eevee, a Flareon, a
Squirtle. He's going to toss up a bubble and then chase the bubble. It was so adorable.
Catch them all. I really hope we get to go to the premiere. Oh my God, it's so good.
How many tickets you guys going to buy?
What is this movie?
One. Did it shut down the internet?
Nine. Yeah. Well, what did you say? It was a penisaur?
A penisaur.
Penisaur. It's a grass type Pokemon. It's the second evolved form of Ivysaur and Bulbasaur.
It's very powerful.
Do you have like a penis sword or a sword penis?
It's a penisaur.
God,
penisaur.
I love him so
Sounds
much.
Like someone has a penisaur.
Right.
Oh, good. Yeah. All right, good for you guys.
Does anybody know if John Tesh wrote the music for Pokemon? Because that sounds like a John Tesh song.
That's a good call.
So what? A little behind the scenes. What do you think just happened? Do you think that Cobster saw this information, came sprinting into Cody, 100%. And let him know?
Yeah. Here's what happened, guys. Alex sent me a text saying they're on sale. And I was like, I got to stop the show.
Well, it was probably good that you did.
So Alex still disrupting the show from 3,000 miles away.
Well, he's just talking to himself right now randomly, trying to talk into a mic.
Here comes Alex. If you guys notice. Whoa, Alex.
If you cut to Alex right now, he's having a conversation with himself.
While he's composing music with his other hand.
Motherfucker.
I'll tell you what is a motherfucking EE is when you're on course. You start out your day and you're like, we're moving today. Yeah. We're moving. And it's like, oh yeah, I'm gonna get my kid in school. Everyone's gonna eat. We're out the door. I got time. And then the motherfucking toilet overflows and spreads and goes through two bathrooms.
Oh no.
And it is like it was my wife and I then just she goes, well, she's gonna be late. and we're just like throwing towels and everything to go into the washing machine and then my daughter goes, well, I'm just gonna play the iPad. And what a morning it was, everyone.
Okay, I'm gonna tell a very honest Josh McCoy story.
This is so unlike you. You hate poopy stories.
I know, I really don't like them. But in my family, Amanda's family too, like everybody's very honest about the pooping situation, right?
Honest, so, how? Like, hey, I gotta take a dump?
No, like, so Amanda's parents live in this ranch house, but there's one bathroom upstairs and there's one in the guest house downstairs.
Is this a Dumb and Dumber story?
No. And so I always go down there to like go to the bathroom and Amanda's mom will be like, where is he? She's like, yeah, he's downstairs pooping. He likes to have private time, right? But so I'm like 13, 14, and I had like, when I as a kid, just had like huge poops. Like they were huge and they would always clog the toilet. Similar thing. I'm like in the basement, in my house in Pittsburgh, families, everybody's getting ready for school. And my dad, you hear my dad go, you clogged that fucking toilet! And I'm downstairs going like, motherfucker!
Trying to chop it up.
So you hear, trying to chop it. My brother comes down. He's like, did you clog it? He was like, Dad's so pissed. So my dad comes running down with like the snake. And he's looking at me with a snake. He's like, I'm going to fucking kill you. I can still see his face as we're late
in the school. News, there's nothing all over the floor. It was all water today, which was fine. But it was not good. It just looked like that scene in the Titanic once they hit the iceberg and the ship just starts to get overflow with everything.
Did you and your wife like huddle and cuddle on the mattress as the water's rising?
Were you handcuffed to the shower?
More or less. Yeah, she was trying to chip it off with an axe.
Just crying.
I wanted to cry. I'm telling you, I saw it. I'm like, motherfucker, I was so close to getting out of this house on time. And that's my private time for like the 10 minutes. 10 minutes before I could get a little peace right before I jump in the shower.
Yeah.
And it was taken away from me.
Yeah,
it was just taken away from me because I do this thing when I'm sitting there and as I look at the clock, I'm always the one waiting by the door, and I scream out, 7 minutes, 3 minutes, and then today I go -6 minutes. Anyway,
that's a situation.
You're quiet over there. You think you have
thoughts? Roxy's not a big poop fan.
No. It's the constant dilemma of like reminding myself that I'm a chick on the internet, so whether or not to share my poop stories.
the things that go through our heads. That and the Zubily Zoo song, right?
Yeah,
that's
so
the truth.
Feminism, it's real.
Yeah.
God damn it! Kristian, you said the word!
I had it out of my head. It was gone.
I had it out too.
It was gone.
I love this song.
Go sing it in a corner.
I live for it.
I've always said that you looked like Steve Carell. That was the most Steve Carell I've ever seen. His whole face turned red.
He does look like Steve
Carell. Oh, he does. Oh, yeah. His teeth came out.
Toby's coming back to be the HR guy.
It's like that giphy that everybody shares where he's like, no!
When you go back and watch this replay, Yeah, there and you see his face.
Please, no.
You said it. You slid it in there, and I went, oh god, and there was a delay, and then he hit it, and it got in.
How was he so quick on that? I thought all the things were in alphabetical order. Then you had to scroll all the way down to Z, Cody.
I have it in a separate tab. Such
an Which one of them dislikes it more?
It started with Makuga, but Riley is because here's the. I sacrificed myself just now because, again...
You're not loving it either. No, I'm the only one who likes it.
It kept me up last night. It kept me up. I couldn't get it out of my head. And it was just in my head as I was trying to sleep. And it's just booming through my head. But I was just like, I had to throw it in there because I got that out of it. And I was so happy to get that.
So I'm the only one who's a legitimate fan.
Of it, yeah.
Good. So everybody that thinks they're funny sending me something, this Instagram message request, and it's just the thing in there. And I go,
John Carpenter's the thing?
I know what that is. I'm not going
to
touch it.
You know, decline. Yeah. Right. It's like send it to you because you can put it on your Walkman or whatever you're doing. And
you know what's funny is that they actually have fans. There's like,
I'm a Zoomly Zoo fan.
Hey, it's awesome. Circle it's awesome. Of life. I'm gonna get that in my head.
Every time Makuga puts it. What are you singing over there, Grandpa?
I'm getting something else in my fucking head right now.
All right,
and it's gonna be.
It's gonna be there on the plane, the whole plane ride.
No.
Roxy did that.
I'm going to somehow get the stewardess to announce that.
Cody,
what flight are you on so I can change it?
Cody, when do you fly out?
Tomorrow night.
Tomorrow night.
Yeah.
Because I would love to play that. Imagine just playing, booming that out throughout. I don't know what difference it makes when Cody was flying out, but just to have what the fuck's he gonna do?
Really
like he's in with the pilot that
but
he can blast
a minute,
it out.
In your
out
mind,
there.
You really were like bummer.
Yeah, I was bummed. I thought that Cody would actually be sitting there playing
That's
sound bites on the plane.
Every idea I have.
Yeah.
I'm all in until.
Yeah. So.
Get it.
Anyway, all right, cool news. There's stuff that's going on in the world of movie news,
sure.
And we'll talk about it.
Offended him a little bit.
What, I offended you a little bit?
You offended me a little bit.
Why, with that music?
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, again, I understand.
Do you want to hear? So my dad was in Lake Tahoe last week with my brother and his family. My mom was back in Pittsburgh. And so he finally got back to Pittsburgh, and I said, Dad, Mom, they were both on the phone together. I was like, do you guys remember a show? And I said the name, and my dad goes, that fucking show. And he goes, you know what I remember about that show is that song would come on, right? And you boys were way too young, and you would already like skip past it. But it was then stuck in my head.
Like, did he say that?
He's like, I remember that awesome. Show. It was Birds, and it was WQED, so it was on the channel. And so you'd hear the song for the commercials for like in between
that
Mr. Rogers.
Is
so you would
amazing.
Hear, you'd be on Mr. Yeah. Rogers, and then the
is your dad working
the
right
commercial.
Now?
Is he working right now?
I should have him call in and talk about it.
No.
Do none of you guys know the one that I'm talking about?
What
come
are you talking
on
about?
And zoom. Come on and zoom.
Come
you
on
do?
And zoom, zoom,
yeah,
zoom.
Yeah, that was
zoom,
our
zoom.
Version oh. of that. And okay. it's like the same oh. thing, but
play
with
that.
The word zoom.
Play it.
Let's hear it.
A second.
Yeah, see if you can find it, Cody. Yeah.
And also, Cody, bring up the law.
Find the law.
Yeah.
Which law?
Before
any law.
Forward, I need to know the law.
Yeah, all of the behind laws. What's the laws about playing music?
Yeah.
Do you know what the law is? Can you do it? Riley, there's music about to be played. But before that music is played, tell us about the news that's going on.
And you want some music that nobody asked for? There's a the Hollywood
ears.
Reporter is saying that we're going to get a prequel to Grease.
Fuck
called
you.
Summer Lovin'.
Yes.
And it's about all on the about beach? It's all about Danny meeting Sandy.
Yes. Listen.
Yeah.
Listen.
Jesus
the whole
Christ.
Reason that this movie worked in the first place is because of the chemistry of Travolta and
thank
and
you.
Yes.
And John.
Stop.
Yeah.
Stop.
Nobody
I
wants to see a recast
feel,
Danny Zuko or Olivia Newton-John.
Really?
Oh, you want this?
Oh, yeah.
What?
Oh,
guys,
ring
no.
it just, on, bitches.
Let me give you... let me just throw some
adjectives,
okay?
Okay.
Do you guys remember the cinematic classic, if you will? I believe they're playing it at Malton Fest. It's called From Justin to Kelly. Oof. It's about
yes,
a
I do.
Beach. It's about a beach musical dance party. Okay.
Yeah.
Listen, if they can make that movie good, which was incredible.
No, was that Justin Guarini and Kelly Clarkson?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, then you can make a Summer Lovin'
Kelly Clarkson?
Absolutely perfect. You mix Summer, you miss From Justin to Kelly with Baywatch with like a splash of, I don't know, the scene in Seinfeld where George gets the Titus out of the whale, and boom, you have Summer Lovin'.
This movie
is incredible.
Written already. in a song. We already know what the movie is.
Let me tell you one movie that I will never see. It's called Summer Lovin'. Yeah. It's going to be the worst movie ever.
Who's in this shit piece?
Okay, so it's being written right now by John August, who wrote Big Fish and Charlie and the Chocolate Factory remake.
Excellent, excellent. Like the
first part Tim Burton's involved?
No, Tim Burton is not involved. There's no director
right
now.
I like Big Fish. Did not like...
Tim Burton killed a guy. He's on the lam. I don't know if you know that.
What?
Yeah.
Tim Burton killed a guy?
You've been out for 2 days. You've been gone a long time.
Clearly.
Maybe you didn't hear. I don't shine shoes no more. Okay?
Yeah. Keep him in.
What a twist. I don't know where we are anymore.
What's happening?
I don't know. Riley, what happened?
That's it. So that's it's John August. That's all we have. Know.
No director, no cast.
No director.
But think of the song.
Yeah.
Think of the song, Summer Lover.
Yeah.
He's talking about having sex with her in the sand. She's talking about it in a way more beautiful way. And we see the flashback at the beginning of the Grease. They're all like holding hands and everything sweet.
Those guys are
20 years too old to be in high school.
But he also shows his person. You don't see the Danny Zuko that you know.
If you're going to get this sweet Danny Zuko with the Sandy.
You don't see the Greaser. Who wants to see this movie?
The whole reason it works is because Danny presents himself in a certain way.
Grease is
not
one of my 10 favorite movies of all time.
So I agree. So I ruin it.
Okay.
I like it too.
What about Grease 2?
No, I did not love that movie. But I'm not upset that it exists. Mm. I don't mind that it exists. Mm. I think that this is a chance. When you watch Grease today, it's a little bit of a bummer when you think about the message behind it, right? All you have to do is change everything you are to be loved. That's essentially the message.
Yeah.
Well, but the actual movie is bomb. I love it. It's my number one favorite stoner movie, true story, too. So I watch this a ton.
Beauty school dropout.
Mm-hmm. But I could use a little refresh. I would love to see what
happened. You're
going
to be singing a different tune if the cast sucks balls.
Who's Zuka?
Yeah.
Who do you put as Zuka?
Who do you
Zac
put
Efron?
As Sally?
He's like
30 years old.
You
Reggie?
Could put
what's the girl's
Zac Efron.
He's like 30 years old.
So was Travolta.
No, Travolta was in his mid-20s.
All right. Well,
but still, even that was too ridiculous.
I'll cast it for you guys.
Okay.
Who are you going to put in there?
Well, I can't do it the second.
Robert Pattinson.
No, he's 30.
Kristen Stewart.
It's supposed to be high school kids.
Yeah, it's probably going to be people we don't even know yet. It's going to be somebody that's on a Netflix show, and they're going to cast him, and then it's going to be, he's the next Danny Zuko. And then
Alex Wolff.
Give it to Brendan Meyer.
That's not a bad Alex Wolff. I like that.
Brendan Meyer?
Not it's Zuko, but Brendan Meyer. That kid, by the way.
One of the T-Boids.
I love him.
I love Brendan Meyer. He is one of my favorite humans in the world.
He's
not
the
only
best.
Is a free-for-all performance, but the kid is like, he's just like
just
a genuine.
Just the nicest guy.
He's
straight. Is he the one that dresses up like Bateman all the time?
No,
that's Brendan Meyer. Brendan Meyer is the kid from
the OA.
And he was also in The Guest, but he competes. He did amazing in the free for all.
I wasn't at the free for all because you scheduled it when I was out of town.
I apologize. But anyway, the kid is
to me a lot too.
He's just amazing. He's just such a very he's plucked out of the 1950s.
I can't
believe
you guys don't want this movie.
Well,
just haters.
You don't want to talk about Brendan Meyer.
That hater
are you shocked that I don't want it because
I'm
I hate so musicals,
surprised.
Right? But
I'm so shocked and disappointed with you.
All right, well, this is shit news. What's next?
Oh,
it's really good.
Way to take a shot at Riley there. All right.
No, not him. I'm saying the news. Is this it?
No, this is
What show is this?
Zoom. This is what we grew up with. You were like
40 when this came out.
No.
It seems Nickelodeon-ish.
Maybe PBS? I don't remember.
Yeah, who cares?
What was it about? Zooming?
It was like about these kids who did activities.
Oh,
kind of like out of the box.
Oh, all right. Look at that. What a rich premise.
They would go audition local kids in their town and then have them do activities.
Oh, okay. Like what? Like jump rope?
Yeah.
Oh, sounds good.
Yeah. Kind of like that.
Amazing the show didn't go off the air.
Right, Cody? Oh, wait. Isn't that what it was?
I think that's right.
Yeah.
I just remember singing.
Come on.
You just remember singing.
Zoom. Come on.
Cody, what song do you like better, that one or the ZZ?
What's the
no?
What are you talking about?
No, but you know,
the ZZ one's better.
I hear him clicking around back there. Wait for that tab to pop up.
He's just ready for it. I didn't ask Leonard Maltin if he knew about it though. I forgot to yesterday.
Yeah,
that's fine. I asked him enough weird questions.
You certainly did.
Did your daughter's husband ever tell her she should swallow him?
Everybody was like, the comment section would say, "What the hell?"
I love that. I wasn't in, and then I was like monitoring the chat, and then all of a sudden it was like, boom, and I'm like, "What the hell happened?"
Yeah. You're welcome.
Yeah.
Yes. All right. Let's do some
more news.
More news.
We got some breaking news here from Variety, and it looks like Disney Plus is getting a Hawkeye series with Jeremy Renner attached, and he's going to pass the mantle of Hawkeye in the series to Kate Bishop, who becomes Hawkeye in the comics.
Yes,
and who people are thinking might be in the trailer.
Yeah.
What's that? Oh, yeah, that's right. And they're thinking maybe it's set up in Endgame.
In Endgame. That'd be smart if they did it that way.
But Disney and Marvel has declined to comment. I think it's because of the implications for Renner's Hawkeye character, because if he's passing the mantle, then
it's
probably looking
post
at
and he's
post
alive.
Endgame.
This is of the Disney Plus series that they've announced. This is the only one that I would be more
really
excited to see.
More so than the Loki one.
I don't like Loki that much.
Oh,
I love
Black Widow.
I love Scarlet Witch. I love Scarlet Witch.
I don't mind the Scarlet Witch series. I'm always confused about what her powers are. As far as like
exactly
magic,
magic.
I mean, I wish they could. I mean, you know, they're not going to be that'd be retconning. But she was a a mutant in the comics.
Right.
That character
makes sense.
All right, same. Well, cool. That's good.
I like that one.
You don't like that, huh?
Well, it's fine. Look,
I expect you to be way more into that.
Yeah,
I don't know enough about it yet. I want to see. I don't know enough about it.
Is he going to get nominated for an Emmy?
Yeah.
I have to see the show. Got to see the show.
Will it be better than Daredevil or, say, a Luke Cage?
It's possible, but I need to see the show before I can come up with an answer.
How about the old show, Bowman? Did you ever see Bowman?
No, I have not.
Is it 1978 through, like, 1982?
You got to be careful going down the line of questioning.
Yeah.
You got to be careful.
I know. Because
you know what we get to.
What do we get to? Bowman 2?
You really want me to answer?
Don't say
it. You really want me to answer what we get to if we go down the line of questioning?
Well, that hasn't even happened yet. I'm talking about Bowman.
Bowman.
He's an archer, also spy, back in the 70s. I think it was played by...
Ralph Biscuits?
No. I think it was Jim Harbinger, I believe.
Jim Harbinger.
Okay. So great.
As Bowman. Are you making this up?
Yes.
No.
He's totally making it up. He's got a tell.
No.
Friday night.
What's my tell?
I don't know how I was able to... I have this thing... To where for when people are doing these silly stories and bullshitting, basically, Ellis does this thing with his face when he's mad. He does his lips. Ken does this thing with his face. I can tell when people are bullshitting. Mm. Like it's not when you're drunk. When you're drunk, you don't. All you do is lie when you're drunk. So it's like you can't tell. That's just what you do when you talk.
Good quality.
Well, he knows. He says that he's self-admitted that he just tells stories when he's hammered. But. He's like, I was playing golf when? 10 minutes ago. With who? Tiger Woods? Really? How'd that go? Good?
It was great.
Told me I was the best he's ever seen.
Yeah, best ever.
Going to his house next week?
Good for you.
Yeah.
Good
so that's what happens. But
Jupiter, Florida.
It's just a tell. It's just a tell. I don't know. So don't play poker with me.
So if Ellis ever quivers his lip, I know he's mad?
He does this thing with his face when he starts to get it, and I'll point it out next time he's pissed off, but he does it.
No.
I know every time he's pissed off.
I bet that pisses him off more. Oh, you're doing it.
I was just
going
to say.
I won't call it out until after he's done.
Okay.
So I'll be like, I knew you were getting pissed because I saw the lip thing. Like I've known him for so long.
I know that pissed off lip. I've only seen it twice. Once when it was coated with the hot sauce, but I know it. Ooh. I can see it. It hurts my eyes to think about it.
Yeah, it curdles
it's real
up.
Real intense.
He does it. You
can
tell.
I've seen it.
You have. You just haven't paid attention to
when
it.
When I went out the emergency exit to smoke my marijuana.
I bet you it started just to form. Yeah, I bet you started to form.
Damn it, cannabis.
Yeah, but anyway, look. Hawkeye's got a series. Okay, what's next?
We have JJ Abrams finally kind of shedding some light on why he came back to episode 9. He spoke with Fast Company. A lot of like why, when he was asked to do it, he hesitated. His wife said, you got to do it, and she's usually right. And so, but he admits it was a daunting prospect and that they did indeed toss out the previous script from Trevorrow. He said to have no script and to have a release date and have it be essentially a 2-year window. When you're saying to yourself, you got 2 years from the decision to do it to release and you have literally nothing. You don't have the story. You don't have the cast. You don't have the designers, the sets. There was a crew and there were things that will be worked on for the version that preceded ours, but this was starting over.
Yeah. Jesus. Well, let's start with that. Basically what he was saying, this is why, again, being yelled at for Jedi Council for the last 2 years when I say there was never a plan.
Yeah.
There was not a plan. It was, okay, director number one, what's your story for your movie? Director number two, what's your story?
Yeah.
Director number three, what's your story? Okay, director number three, we don't like your story. Director number one, do you want to tell your story again or a new story? Sure. So now director number one is back. And that's what he just confirmed.
So you're saying you like The Last Jedi?
But he confirmed it, and he confirmed that it was, and then he goes into more comments about the Rian Johnson thing.
Yeah,
which
so
is,
The Force Awakens then goes on to say another daunting challenge was picking up where Rian Johnson left off, and it was a completely unknown scenario, he said. I had some gut instincts about where the story would have gone, but without getting in the weeds of on episode 8, that was a story that Rian wrote and was telling based on 7 before we met. So he was taking the thing in another direction. So we also had to respond to episode 8. So our movie was not just following what we had started, it was following what we had started and then had been advanced by somebody else.
Wait, why are you guys so pissed?
Because it just goes to show you that there wasn't a plan for three movies.
Yeah.
There was a plan they were going to release three movies. Well, there wasn't a plan to make them all.
And what they also did, the plan, there was no plan to basically tell Rian Johnson wasn't held to complete what J.J. Abrams set up.
Right.
It was basically Kathleen Kennedy going, oh, we like your vision. What do you want to do with it? Sure, do that.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
What do you want to do? Sure, do that.
Instead of Kevin Feige being like, this is what we're doing.
Where we need to go.
He already has a 5-year plan after Endgame.
Yeah. So we need you to execute this particular way. So then this is, again, J.J. Abrams. I don't want to do the I told you so stuff, but same thing. They had not talked. They're not it's this whole thing where he came out and said, oh, I read it. I love what he's doing. It's the same thing James Cameron. When James Cameron came out and said, oh, I love Genesis. It was amazing. he now is saying it in the most political way possible of he did his thing. I'm doing my thing. I'm connecting what I did to 7 because I kept saying this is pretty much a direct this number 9 is going to be a direct sequel to 7. And all the fans are like, oh, keep saying that. It's just stupid. Why are you saying that? Because it makes sense. He's making a movie that he didn't number 8 was the way that it was. It was a movie, whether you like it or not. It was the movie that was set that they put into motion. He you like that one, huh? So he's completing what he set up in 7.
Right. Well, I'm not.
What are you cracking up about?
Really? So, like, usually when you do the troll, you get real angry. But that one, you were cracking. You're like, blah, blah, blah,
blah. It's just so stupid. It's like, I said the same thing. What do you think of the emperor? Is that the emperor? What do you think that? Is that the emperor? I mean, I'm going to see it. I don't know why you get to. Why do you think you know all this stuff, man? You don't know anything.
Oh, my God.
Well, and Ryan came out and said he would have no problem if JJ retconned Ray's parents. So everything's in play.
How great would we have a Black Mirror situation at Star Wars Celebration? I'm sorry, Rex.
That's okay.
If we have a Black Mirror situation at Star Wars Celebration, everyone you go by has like a little hologram above their head that gives the screen name from YouTube that they've harassed you with about Last Jedi, and you're like, shame.
But it's just like, no, the thing is, you don't have to agree with what anyone is saying.
Sure.
But it's just like, the way say, all right, said. Well, yeah, it, exactly. It's like, so if someone says something along the lines of, I think that from what I'm seeing so far, when I said this a year ago, that I don't think that J.J. Abrams and Rian Johnson were on the same page for their stuff.
Yeah.
And going, okay, well, I don't really agree with what you're saying, Harlow, if I believe that it would, as opposed to, you know, the ones that are just like, you don't know what you're talking about. How do you know that?
Yeah.
How do you know that?
Yeah. Well, they know. They have a Twitter account. Right. So they have the wall there in front of them.
I'm just saying, J.J. Abrams pretty much has confirmed. No, he didn't. You know, we didn't come into it.
But listen, for me, this is very telling. Without getting into the weeds on episode 8, I found that the most telling thing in the quote.
He's telling you that,
I don't want to go there.
He's telling you that what was set up at 8 was not where he would have went with it,
right?
And it's not what he was going to do, and it's not what was planned. They did not coordinate. These two stories did not coordinate. It was not
That's
what
the problem
set up.
With not either having one. I mean, one of three is how I see it. One, Kathleen Kennedy didn't get all three directors or two directors and be like, this is what the story's going to look like.
100%.
Or two, the problem of having three separate directors for three different movies. Like, if you were going to do the trilogy, JJ, you're on for all three.
Now,
that's your thing.
But the thing is, you look at more like Marvel.
Sure.
But Marvel has been able to do it to where it's like you're connecting universes, and even the first Avengers.
That's why I go back to like refer to one. Kathleen Kennedy and the whole people, like the whole team, should have been like, this is where the story
where
is going. These are our directors to do it.
Well, this is why I go back to the fact that I think she's an amazing producer. I think she is. When you need her to execute a movie and find that she found the talent to make money, make the movies, but she does. She just, and I don't expect everyone to love Star Wars. She respects the fan base. So she respects the product, but she's not a hardcore fan like the way Feige is with MCU stuff too. Right. But you have to have a narrative. From 7's going to start here, and we need it to end here. If it's J.J. Abrams that comes in and sets it up, all right, J.J. set it up. We need to end here. So Rian and Colin, figure out how to make 8 weave into 7, and then Colin tried to figure out how to make 9 weave into 8 and 7.
Yeah.
That was never the plan. And JJ just confirmed that.
I was saying this on
Roxy's got. Go ahead, Roxy.
I cut off Roxy.
Oh, my God. That was so long ago.
Yeah.
Going back to Roka's point about retcon, I don't feel like you necessarily even call it retcon, because sometimes people tell one story and then something else is true. So both things could be true.
A retcon. Yeah.
She could be saying this is what I thought my parents were, and then that could change.
Right.
As in life happens all the time. And then I completely agree with everything you guys are saying. My personal issue is that I much prefer Rian Johnson's vision. So that's my personal my personal.
You liked 8 better than 7. Yeah, that's
infinitely.
Yeah, there you go.
And so going into this, I don't want to hear that we're going back again. I know I just opened Pandora's box, and if you disagree with me, that's totally fine. Right. I get why, but I would rather take 8 and make 9 than take 7 and make 9.
And that's your prerogative, and that's going to be a lot of people's opinion. But we all can't deny that from these comments, comments say
that
7 was mine, 8 was his, 9 is mine. There's connecting to 7.
Yeah, definitely what it's saying. Yes. I just wish it wasn't.
Yeah, but that's,
you can like these movies, whether it's Force Awakens more than Last Jedi or Last Jedi and vice versa, but you can look at the behind the scenes stuff. Everything is informing me in this. Like losing Lord and Miller, losing Colin Trevorrow, there are things that have been changing. And somebody, we talked about this on Rule of Two yesterday. Somebody comes at me hard and they're like, no, that's bullshit because look at the original Star Wars trilogy, 3 different directors. I'm like, George Lucas was so heavily involved.
He pretty much directed Jedi.
He was there with the Irvin Kershner.
The only one for Empire was the one, that was the only one. And he didn't like a lot of the stuff that was done because he was offset for a lot because he was dealing with other things.
He was building ILM. He still hired his teacher.
Right. He hired his teacher to do the vision. But Irvin Kershner made a lot of that directing side his own, very similar to what they're trying to do. But there was a narrative, though. It was they were following George Lucas's story.
Exactly.
You're saying George Lucas didn't like Empire, some of the decisions they were making?
Yeah. If you read, again, How Star Wars Conquered the Universe. It is Chris Taylor's book, and anytime I have a chance to rave about it, you would actually love it. You would love it. It is such a good, intricate way. And I want to read his follow-up because if he ever does one.
Yeah, he should.
Of the stuff that's going with the new era. But it is brilliant, and it tells you all about that stuff. And yes, you're right, Riley, because he was very involved.
He was very involved.
And so just because you have 3 different directors doesn't mean it's the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
It means
you still have a through line.
Exactly.
And everybody can sit at dinner, drink.
And then, the argument will then come. Doing. They didn't know where they were going with the original Star Wars. They knew enough. They knew a lot because the first movie came out, he had ideas of where he was going. Now George Lucas will tell you that he had an idea for the original trilogy and he didn't. He didn't even know when episode 1-4 came out, he didn't know that Darth Vader was Luke's father. He didn't know any of that stuff.
But he had the broad strokes.
But then he started kind of piecing it together and they knew, well, once four, I keep saying one, four was such a big hit, they knew, oh, let's plan this thing out to be a trilogy.
No, and he swung for the fences too because he completely financed Empire Strikes Back, and then to go with that story, because if Empire doesn't work, there's no Return of the Jedi.
Right.
That thing dies.
There's no Star Wars period.
I mean, especially the Yoda puppet. If that thing doesn't work, then we have a whole different situation.
It's true. So anyway, this is why I think, and I've never thought of this term as an ugly term. Some people do, and they say fan service, right? And I think sometimes fan service when it's
Too many cooks.
Yeah, but sometimes when fan service is done, it's just like, oh, they're just trying to please everybody too. I think sometimes fan service, like last season of Game of Thrones, I know book lovers don't love it. I loved it. It was one of my favorite seasons. Loved it. I think there's going to be a lot of fan service in this movie and good fan service. And I think that's why one of the main reasons I think Palpatine's coming back. That's why I think there's going to be a lot more lightsabers. That's why I think there's going to be stuff that he'll never say this, but you guarantee if you're a director coming onto your next movie off of a sequel that is very divisive, made a lot of money, but divisive between the fans. You would look at the criticisms, the main criticisms, and there are people who are just screaming out into the void, you ignore that. But the main criticisms that keep coming back up that you wonder, maybe you loved, right? But maybe a lot of the other Star Wars fans didn't like it. Why not switch stuff up if you can? Why? You're not going to bring Luke back. You can't bring – I mean, you bring him back as a Force ghost, but you can't resurrect him. That you can't do because that's really – then you're really showing your cards.
You're really screwing with the mythology here.
That you can't do.
That would be wild.
Yeah, he won't do that. But you can do stuff to where like what you just said with like Rey's parentage. That you can do.
Yeah.
That because she mentioned it. Maybe Kylo was lying to her. Maybe he wasn't. Maybe going back –
that works in the villain kind of arena where
if he's
villain,
a cult cut thing.
Yeah. Maybe. Or maybe even the fact that we were talking about yesterday. Maybe she was given to those people, the junk traders, and she thought they were her parents, and then Kylo thought they were her parents.
Or he's protecting her for some reason, or he's trying to steer her down a different path. It's not retcon if you bring it into the story.
If it makes sense.
Yeah.
Correct. And I think that there's ways to do that. I think JJ will, maybe him going, oh, I had a clear-cut thing of what I wanted to do. That's his bad for leaving, though.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. Because I was going to say, why doesn't he sit down and go, this is where I wanted to go?
I want to take the trilogy. Give me all three.
So like, is he like, up top. Does he do Force Awakens? And he's like, have fun. And he's out? That's what it feels like.
That's what he's always done, though. Yeah. He's done Star Trek, Mission Impossible. He's done one, then he's out. Right? But now he wants to come. Now he's coming back to fix up maybe – and. You know, maybe he didn't like a lot. Maybe he didn't like 8 at all. Maybe he hated 8, right? And then maybe that was one of the reasons when they said, do you want to come back? And then he's like, all right, because Colin Trevorrow stuff was just not working behind the scenes.
Even if he didn't hate 8, it probably wasn't what he was picturing. And so he probably looked at it like, ah, oh, I wouldn't have done that. I wouldn't have done that.
Yeah.
Even if he's not hating it, it's still like, yeah. I started something else. That's not my vision.
And maybe he realized it's his oof.
It's ironic that he's doing it again. Because remember, you could argue the prequels, same thing. Divisive. Some people liked them. Some people didn't.
Right.
JJ had to come in and bring people back to Star Wars.
And he's
got to
do it again.
He's got to do it again here on the heels of Ryan Johnson. It's very interesting.
It's a good point. Because there, like you said, there are people who love both prequels. I love 8. We have 2 of them in the room right now. And yeah, that's exactly right.
What is
right.
the majority? I'm just curious.
I mean, it's tough because I think when
it's
you
very, very split.
It's split. I don't know how. See, that's the thing, though.
I think it's 60-40.
I don't know how split it is, and I'll tell you why. And I'm coming from someone who's not a big fan of the movie, right? Star Wars fans, like the if you're asking as far as hardcore Star Wars fans go, then I would say it's split. Yes. When you talk about overall opinions, I would say it leans heavily into more people liking it than disliking it. The casual fan, because for example, like I always use like my wife or my dad as examples, they're not. Tying into it, like my brother is a hardcore Star Wars fan and he hates it, right? Now, but my dad and my wife, they love it because they're not saying, oh, well, Luke wouldn't have done that. And and this wouldn't have happened. And
why I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Why are they telling jokes? Why is this? They don't know the
rules.
That's
not my Luke.
So the hardcore Star Wars fan either finds like Ken and you guys finds like the stuff that you do feel is like Star Wars. To me, it doesn't feel like a Star Wars movie. It just, there's a lot of stuff inside that doesn't feel like it. And so for me, I'm not a big fan of it. So I think it's split on hardcore fans.
The more you watch it, the more you like it, or less you like it.
Less. I just watched it again with my daughter the other day, and I don't mind the beginning.
How does she feel?
She liked it. She liked it a lot. Yeah, and she's 7. You know,
I wish we would have thought about this earlier. Have you ever seen those like memes out there where there's a guy at a desk that says like, "The Earth is flat. Prove me wrong."
Yeah.
And he's sitting at a table. I wish each day of Star Wars Celebration we would have picked a new topic and me sitting at a desk, right? And
tell you why.
Episode 8 is the best Star Wars. Prove me wrong.
Right.
Like, tell me why it's not or something. And just seeing what kind of footage we could get from people sitting down to talk to me.
Yeah, it's true. Well, I mean, it's
could be pretty damn fun.
It could be fun. Yeah. I mean.
Can I come?
You should. But to answer your question as far as why I watched some of the stuff, the jokes bother me up top, like the Marvel jokes, which I like in Marvel, don't really like them in Star Wars. The stuff with right up top with that Hux and Poe telling the
jokes. How can you feel Hux is any kind of powerful guy?
He's not.
He'd be tricked that easily. How does he even rise to that rank to lead this whole freaking it's ridiculous.
Yeah, but the whole that opening scene I really like a lot, though, you know, when it comes to the actual bombings and all that is cool. And then once you get it, like, I thought he completely fumbled Finn, because Finn had this whole arc that he ended with in episode 7, and then he's right back to where he started with in episode 7. He was the same exact guy he was in the beginning of 7 after he's gone through all of this stuff. And the stuff with Rose and Canto Bight, I hate it.
It's interesting because I asked you if you like it less or more, because I find that the people that like it more and more every single time.
Interesting.
And the people who don't like it like it less and less every single time.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I like it more and more as I watch it, but I can also see the Canto Bight stuff in Finn, to your point.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm sitting there going, it's not working.
Oh, it's not a flawless film.
No. It's not flawless.
Because especially the Luke's. No, I think that the people who really like it and start to like it more, you really accept the Luke stuff.
Yeah.
If you're a hardcore Star Wars fan and you really are against the Luke stuff, then you like it less and less. And that's where I am. Because I really wish, because it was funny. The first time I saw the movie, I was kind of confused and had to think about it. Second time I saw it, I wound up liking it a lot. And then I would watch it more and start to analyze it and look at it more and more and more. And then the stuff with Luke, I can't stand the stuff with Luke. I hate what they did with
Luke. Is that your biggest problem with them?
I think so. Yeah, I can't stand what they did with Luke. I think that I wanted to see, and it says, well, you may have wanted to see that, but that's not what you got. And it's the truth.
Facts.
And it's the truth. But I wanted to see that there was a rumored scene going on with Luke to where he and Rey were fighting against the Knights of Ren in Ahch-To, and there's this big lightsaber fight. I was like, how powerful is Luke now? Let me see that. And I never got that. I got what I got more in like the Battlefront.
I would have loved more powerful Luke.
I wanted to see him like what he knew. Now I have to learn about it in novels or video games. I'm like, I never got to see that.
Yeah. The biggest mistake they ever made was not having the three of them in a scene together. Like, why would you make that stupid decision to not have the three characters that have tied us over and kept us going?
At least
loving,
once.
At least once.
Yeah, my argument against that.
Even the Luke Leia scene isn't real because Luke's a freaking apparition.
Right.
He's not actually physically there for her. So it's just like those kinds of things that
and
that's really big.
And Mark
mistakes.
Hamill had
you
a big problem.
You loved the movie, Roka?
I didn't. I love the everything after the first 45 minutes is fucking great. The first 45 minutes are terrible. After that, it's fucking great.
You know.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and I know.
I haven't heard that.
It's just breaking. Oh, is it time to go to break?
Yeah.
All right, it's about time. All right, listen. I knew we were going to get into that conversation. Let's go.
I'm sure the fans have been so nice.
No way. let's go to break.
It's awful in there.
Really? Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. Oh yeah, it's terrible.
I'm shocked.
No, the YouTube comments stink. All right, let's go. Let's go to break. Go to the Facebook group too. You want to have like actual classy conversations? Go there. Like the stink boxes and turds will scream at each other in the YouTube comments.
I told you I'm in a different lotion. Don't
call
me that.
Oh, sorry. Go over to the Facebook group. Have a good comment. Have some. Good conversations. We will be back to talk about the Lion King trailer. Man, that was something fun.
Hey, Collider fans, John Rocha here. Look at that behind me. There it is, Collider Sports. That's right, that is happening. We've got some great programming on there already. For those of you that have already watched, thanks so much. We got so much coming down the pike. We're talking about NFL. We're going to talk about NBA. There's plans about NHL. Golf is in the equation now. And, of course, the Premier League show that I host with Jack Hind, that's been in motion for the last couple of weeks. And then an MMA show is on the way from Dennis Zhang, me and Jay Williams. All those things are happening here at Collider. And look, we want to hear from you, so we want you to listen. We want you to watch. If you're a sports fan, even if you're not a sports fan, we might entertain you, teach you something new about a sport that you may not have known much about, or maybe so deep into it that you wanted to learn even more about it. We've got you covered. You can do that. Follow us on iTunes and on YouTube. You can there watch all the shows or listen to all the shows that you want, and then leave us comments and rate the shows as well and review them, and then let us know what other sports you want us to cover. Look, we're not touching rugby. I'll just tell you that right now. That's as far out as we'll go, or cricket. But maybe in the future, if we go Collider worldwide, that's certainly a possibility. But for right now, Collider Sports is there for you. Take a look at it, take a watch, and let us know what you think.
Oh, hi, guys. It's Perry here, and I am going to tell you about The Witching Hour. It is the show that I host along with Collider.com's Haley Fouch. It is in podcast form on the Collider Factory feed, and we also have the video up and running every Tuesday for you right there on the Collider Podcast YouTube channel. We talk about everything horror. We're talking TV, movies, the newest releases. We talk about movies that are celebrating anniversaries. We've even talked about books. It's crazy. If it is scary, we are talking about it on The Witching Hour. We also have so many filmmaker interviews, really cool stuff. It's all coming your way every single Tuesday on The Witching Hour. Check it out. Collider Factory and the Collider Podcast YouTube channel.
Hello, Collider Live. My name is Amy Dallin.
And I'm Coy Jondro, and we host a little show we love called Collider Heroes. And it is all of the things we love about movies, TV, comics themselves, all the breaking news, trailers, photos, but not paparazzi photos.
All of the superhero stuff we love, all of the indie comic stuff we love, all the stuff you had no idea was based on comics.
80 years of comic lore have led to this show and many years in film and TV, and we're living in a golden age of comics, and we want to share all of that zeal with you folks.
So we talk about the stuff that's coming out. We talk about what we hope is coming out. We do fantasy casting of things that should exist. Why don't they exist?
And we do your Twitter questions asking directly to us what we think of certain things. And every single week, since we both actually love and read physical comics by in print, we have a comic pull list where our five biggest favorite books of the week come out, and we dive into those with you guys.
You can buy digital. I'll forgive you. As long as you're paying for your comics, it's all good.
But if you buy in print, you can bag them and board them, and then they're worth more later, because comics are like certain things from the 90s that are totally worth the value. Buy comics. Buy in print. Digital's never worth anything later. Buy in print. Keep comic stores alive.
Or we can debate collector's items all day long. We can debate casting. We can debate movie news. We can have all of our friends come join us, as we frequently do. We can ask professionals about their work. We've had some amazing guests come by the show.
Yep.
We try to catch it every Wednesday.
That are on these properties that also love comics. You hear what it's like from their perspective, from inside, from outside. And this is all with the focus of bringing all this news to you guys. And we're here every Wednesday on Collider. And we love this stuff and want to share it with you guys.
We'll see you then.
Hey guys, Riley here, and let me tell you about the Riley Roundtable. That's right, they gave Riley his own podcast. The Riley Roundtable is on its new home. It drops every Thursday. The Riley Roundtable is a little bit about everything. It's about movies and life, life and movies and everything in between. I like to have on special guests for discussions like Justice League versus Batman v Superman, for discussions about wine tasting, for discussions about UFOs, and everything in between. That's right, the Riley Roundtable drops on Thursdays on the One-on-One with Christian Harloff podcast feed, and later on Collider Video's own podcast video network. So check it out every Thursday, the Riley Roundtable. See you there.
Hey everyone, John Rocha here, one of the hosts for Collider Sports Time. That's our new show there on the Collider Sports Network. It's our flagship show, just like Collider Movie Talk. We get on, talk about a bunch of sports issues of the day and what is burning up social media, what topics are burning up social media. That's what we do on Collider Sports Time. I'm joined by my top 10 co-host, Matt Nost. Me and him, we welcome a bevy of guests every week to talk about NFL, the Major League Baseball playoffs, NHL, and the NBA, which is starting up soon. We're going to talk about that. We also get into UFC stuff, college football, all the stuff that's happening in the world of sports. We're going to cover it on Collider Sports Time. And we're going to take the time to break it all down and give our opinions and our unique takes and unfiltered thoughts on what we think about the sports news of the day. So don't forget to join us every week on Monday for the Collider Sports Time show on the Collider Sports Network. And don't forget to subscribe on the Collider Sports Network on YouTube and on the Collider Sports podcast feed. We're going to bring you all kinds of stuff. Hope to hear from you soon.
Shoes and beef.
Shoes and beef.
Beef. Shoes, beef. Beef and shoes. Shoes. Shoes and beef.
Shoes and beef.
Shoes and beef. Welcome back to Collider Live, everybody. It's the Shoes and Beef Hour. And it is 11 o'clock, and we are very, very... What happened now? What'd you do?
No, what if every Wednesday we're like, and welcome to the second hour of Collider Live. It's the Shoes and Beef Hour. We just take off our shoes and we eat beef. Some beef.
We should do Shoes and Beef Hour, but you can literally take any song
and put Shoes and Beef in it.
It's incredible. Yeah, it's just.
So, growing up, did you, I mean, I'm sure you did, but you know, like when you got together with family, there was one aunt that always made the same hors d'oeuvre. Did you ever have that? Like
onion dip. Just onion a big dip. Onion okay. dip my aunt would make, yeah.
Sure. So my aunt made this,
how you doing over
this
there?
Beef ball.
Sure. I have to get this tweet out.
What
it's
is the
as
tweet?
Important as the beef ball. I still haven't done it.
About the show?
The show.
Why would you do it on the air?
Because I tried to do it off, but then people
were
listening
talking. To the fucking beef
I'm
ball
listening
story.
About the yeah, aunt and the beef ball.
Fuck. Finish with the beef ball story.
Interrupted the beef ball story.
Because I asked him a question, and I said, "What did you have?" And he said, "Onion dip." And then all of a sudden, you're over there.
That's not what happened.
No, no, no. I interrupted you by asking you why you were interrupting the beef ball story, but not paying attention.
I was paying attention. I can multitask.
I don't like what you're doing.
Guys, the tickets are on.
Yeah.
Five or what? Group screening? Guys, want to go?
Penis sore?
I will say, if anybody in this office goes to Pokemon without Cody or Cobster, there will be hell to pay.
I know it's true.
Assholes.
Cody,
are we even invited?
I don't want to go.
Yeah, Cody, someone said something very offensive about you in the comment section.
What?
They called you a meth Tom Holland. I don't think that's fair.
That's
nice.
Pretty
funny.
That's what I said.
That doesn't even mean.
Well, I banned him for that, so fuck that guy.
Yeah, get him.
Cody does like meth. There was a meth bar at his wedding. It was pretty sick.
Oh, it's a meth bar at his wedding?
Yeah. Wow, that's the new whiskey bar?
Huge.
So speaking of meth, the beef ball.
Beef ball.
I got my tweet out.
So, good for you.
So my aunt had this. It was like a cream cheese and beef and like a bunch of chives. I mean, it was amazing. Sounds this thing amazing. Tastes, but for every major holiday, she would shape it like a holly thing for Christmas or like a bunny for Easter, right?
I can smell it. I can literally smell it.
We could do a shoe beef ball.
All right,
I'll get her. I'll get the recipe.
Okay, and I'll make that really
beef
works.
And shoes. Yeah. Beef and
that,
shoes.
That was going on at CPK.
That's where it started.
I'll get a shoe mold. Yeah. And I'll put the beef ball in it, and then
I gotta get. You know, Snap was working on that with me because Brett and I came up with an animated series of shoes and beef back in 2002. We have the packets. We have the artwork. Our buddy Mike Vogel did the artwork for it. And I told Schnepp about it. And he loved it. He loved the idea of the premise of it and what we wanted to do with it. And he was going to help us with it. But all right. Let's.
You know what the meanest thing you can do to beef is?
What?
Add cheese to it.
You're wrong. No. Cheese is great on everything.
Just thinking about it. My father-in-law's in town, and he wants me to. He loves when I grill him burgers because his birthday's coming up. And I'm
I love when you grill burgers too. Can I have one?
Have you had one?
No, I just love burgers.
You take the two patties.
Yeah.
And you put like a cheddar cheese and like in between it, and then grill it. So when you take
you gotta
it,
get real cheddar though.
Like, off the block. Yeah, none of that BS. Yeah,
a little like I do.
Or like blue cheese you could put in there.
Blue cheese. Yeah. So I put soyaki in the burger too.
Well done.
What's that?
Soyaki sauce.
Yeah, that's good.
It's soyaki.
Oh, it's sauce. Not cheese.
No, soyaki.
I haven't done that.
You would like the soyaki. I'll do a barbecue.
You did one. I wasn't invited, but I know
you
had one.
It was for my birthday,
yeah. Yeah, I know.
I know. It was before I really knew you.
Was it this year?
Yeah, it wasn't this year.
No. It was this year.
No, it was not. My birthday's not this year.
Okay, it was in the past year.
I don't have
a
birthday this year. It's over. It's done. They said no more after the last year because we really brought the house down. two kids. Fucking pinatas. All right, let's move on. But we're talking about this trailer. It dropped yes. The Lion King trailer. We've been expecting this thing to drop for a long time. It finally does. We saw footage of it when we went to D23 and knew already what Jon Favreau had been up to from the Jungle Book and now carrying it over. We finally get to see an actual trailer this time around. It looks incredible.
Oh,
I know,
God
forbid you say it's live action. The thing looks live action. Is it animated? Sure, it's animated, but it looks live action. And I cannot wait to see it. I think there's... people will argue with you and tell you, well, this it looks so similar to everything that's going on. It's just a remake of the original. It's not going to be any different. I got the feels from this, the music playing, the Hans Zimmer stuff.
I started tearing up. Yeah. 100%. So the only thing I'm more excited for than the prequel to Grease is this movie. the trailer was exactly what I was hoping it would be.
Scar looks great.
Oh, right?
I know that for most people but for me, this is definitely top two Disney movies. Yeah. God, I love this movie.
It's funny that you say that, though, too, because people always ask me, like, my top animated, not including the Pixar stuff, right? And I always go between, like, Aladdin and whether it's...
mine are Aladdin and this.
Yeah, Aladdin, Lion King, Beauty and the Beast.
Little Mermaid.
I like it, but it's not one of my favorites.
It's one of mine.
My favorite.
And as I'm watching this trailer, I realize that I think Lion King is hands down my favorite.
100%. Yeah, it's mine. Yeah, yeah. It's
Jungle Book's another one I like, but
it's one of the best. The original, because that Hans Zimmer score, Elton John.
Yeah,
the story. Yeah.
It's so good. You know, the other one I think is my favorite, just because I'm a weirdo, and I have just because I also have memories that connect to it. I think it's my all time favorite is Alice in Wonderland.
Mm-hmm.
That's my all time favorite. But then
I don't think that makes you a weirdo. At all. Alice in Wonderland is wonderful.
It's you don't really hear people saying that that's their number one.
It's just because you like drugs.
Well, that's part of it. No, I'm kidding. it's because of the nonsense. That movie is pure nonsense.
Yeah, I hate that movie.
I love that movie.
You hate that movie?
Oh, it's terrible.
The animated.
It's not terrible.
Yes.
There,
yeah. I hate
wow.
it.
Wow.
Yeah. No, but I do love Lion.
Mustard? Let's don't be silly. Lemon, that's different.
Yeah.
That's really good. That's really good.
Man.
Yeah, this one is just... the lessons, the story, the music, everything that sticks with you, and then watching it again, especially for you, Kristian, I would imagine having kids, how exciting this is.
I thought about my oldest immediately because she loves Lion King. Loves it. Started watching The Lion Guard, the spinoff show, because of it. Loves it. And I cannot wait to take her to see this because now she's a perfect age for it.
Yeah.
I'm going to go back for my childhood to see it for sure. Ugh. But I actually am more excited to see how she – because she knows the story. She knows the moments. And she gets to see these this like live action, quote unquote, take it easy, Bibiani, come to life. So I'm excited. I'm excited to see
Dude,
it.
Dude, I tweeted out it looks like a scripted Blue Planet because, everything about it looks absolutely incredible.
Hans Zimmer coming back.
It's just awesome. Yeah. Even hearing James Earl Jones talk.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the Scar and that whole look to the whole thing. It just looks incredible. And I couldn't care less if every beat was the exact same and we saw it like this, I'd still love it.
Yeah.
Do we know what they're doing with the music?
Yeah, they're redoing the Elton John songs. There's like but two Beyonce, or three of them.
Yeah, which
Beyonce is writing new ones.
Because she's also the voice of Nala, isn't she?
Yeah. We know which ones.
Yeah, Nala.
Right. We know which ones they're putting in?
I think so. I think that definitely the opening.
Yeah, the Circle of Life. Can You Feel the Love?
Yes.
Can't Wait to Be King. I think they're not doing Be Prepared.
They're not.
I love that song.
They're not, me too. Yeah.
Do you know if they're doing anything from the musical?
Yeah, I wish they would. I was hoping they did that with Beauty and the Beast.
They have to do Hakuna Matata.
There's a great song in the play musical.
Oh, it's amazing. That's what I'm talking
about.
Mufasa.
Yeah.
No, the one I like is It Says a Morning.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But long and the short.
Have you heard the Mufasa song? Yeah, they live in you. Like when he's telling him about the kings and that you're a part of it, it's this song that's gorgeous in the stage play.
That's in the movie. They live in you.
Yeah, that's the play. No, they didn't put it in the movie.
That's not in the movie.
Mm-mm. Oh my god!
It's in the play. Made
I just
for
listened
the
to
play.
Soundtracks so many times.
Yeah. I'm excited for this movie because I do want to, because like I said, the stuff that I like about these remakes is when they spin off some of the stuff that they stick to the lore. And if you look inside of that trailer, they stick to a lot of the lore, but there's going to be new things. Like you were just talking about with the Broadway play, the new things that they did, there will be new things that they do. And I'm excited for that part of it, but I want to see this story told this particular way. Jon Favreau really showed he knows what he's doing with the Jungle Book. So I cannot wait.
Think that Jonathan Taylor Thomas will be on the red carpet at the premiere?
I think so. Yeah. Right. Yeah, I think so. With Matthew Broderick.
Okay.
Yeah, for sure.
They should.
Yeah, it'll be a nice little reunion that they have for sure. I would love to see it. Jeremy Irons.
That's not in the movie.
No, it's
I can't get over
it's
true. Really?
No. Hey, I'm curious what people think about it though. What's the fans thinking about it? What are the nice fans?
And I'm not curious.
I will say this, and this is what as we were leaving though too. I say I will tell you that the YouTube comments, there are a lot of good people in there too. But the majority of the fart bags come out too. So
one of my biggest pet peeves is when somebody says like, oh, well, that movie's just a ripoff of Hamlet. Or, like, that's just...
Right.
It's not a ripoff. Shakespeare, like, basically made these things, and we just...
Star Wars is
the Seven
Samurai, man.
Yeah.
Borrow whatever
you want.
You
can borrow whatever you want. Avatar is Ferngully. We've been over this. It still... They have their it's. Do I want to go and sit through a four-hour Hamlet? No. Do I want to sit through a live-action Lion King that has Hamlet borrowings? No. Absolutely.
I'm excited for this movie. July. Look at this. Again, just going back to... Avengers comes out in a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Then Aladdin.
Yeah.
Then this. It's like... This is the most... stacked Disney's ever had.
Then
Frozen 2.
100%. This year, Frozen 2, then Episode 9.
What else do they have?
They have a ton
this
of stuff.
This is a big friggin' year.
And I looked at their release schedule next year. It's good, but this is the year for them.
This is,
they're never going to have a year like this
never.
Again.
They're doing my two favorite. Aladdin and Lion King.
Aladdin, Lion King, Endgame, and Episode 9.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me? That's crazy.
And there's another one we're missing too.
And Frozen 2.
No,
Frozen 2 is
another.
Be huge.
I think we're missing a.
Dumbo. I know. I feel
an
like
additional
we're...
thing.
Dumbo. So,
well, Dumbo came out.
No. It's more of a. Let me look.
Yeah, look
at the Hawkeye series.
Bring up the release schedule, Cody, if you can. We'll look
Spider-Man.
But that's a
co-production. It's one that I wasn't as excited for, but still, I'm pretty sure.
Is it Maleficent 2? Is that next year?
Two.
No. Well, let's see.
Star Wars Land, the movie.
Captain Marvel came out already, so that was big for them. They already crossed $1 billion on that. Dumbo didn't do great.
Artemis Fowl.
Hold on. Aladdin. Toy Story 4. That's it.
Toy Story 4. But right. Artemis is the one I was thinking about that I was not.
What you were thinking of Artemis over Toy Story 4?
I was not that excited for one of them.
Toy Story 4 is going to make a crazy amount of money. Artemis Fowl, Frozen 2. Episode 9. I mean, so this is next year. Next year, I don't know what this is. Onward. That's probably a Pixar movie. Yeah, it's a Pixar movie.
Oh, yeah, that's the in a fantasy world. Oh, okay. It's like gargoyles and elves.
Cool.
And
that's cool. Mulan.
One of my also favorites.
Okay. Maleficent 2, no thank you. Jungle Cruise. And that's it. And there's a bunch of other things. So, yeah, this year, this is a miracle year for
Mulan is such an underrated movie.
Totally agree.
It is one of the most badass women. Like, when I get asked about who some of my growing up role model characters were, God, yes. I just think that it's so crazy how little credit that movie gets in terms of what are the best Disney.
You know, just didn't have like a breakout song from Mulan.
You know what it also was?
The Man Out of You?
It did, Man Out of You. It had some songs. But you know what it was, though?
But they didn't, it wasn't like, oh my God, it was the number one Billboard. Like, Colors of the Wind.
Yeah. Yes, play this. This is one of my favorites.
You get a flag for this one, I'll tell you that. But
I'm just saying this didn't have the same cachet. I'm saying pop culture across the board, Billboard 100. Mulan didn't have that.
There's also a reason why. Because
I get what you're saying.
If you go back, I agree, but you go back to that time of Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Little Mermaid, Lion King, right? That was in the height of that style of animation also. It was that style of animation was it. And then 95 hits, because this Mulan, I think, was 94.
Okay.
And I think
Lion King was 94.
So when was Mulan? Like 96?
Maybe 97?
Then it definitely makes my point.
I don't know.
Then.
Let me see.
Because 95 changed the game completely.
98.
Wow. So that makes my point completely.
Wow, 95, trivia schmodown.
Yeah. 95 changed the game with Toy Story. Yeah. When Toy Story came out, they was like, oh, what's this kind of animation? Because people were starting to get, I think unfairly, tired of that type of style animation, because the Mulans and Tarzans, they didn't have that type of hit the way that Hercules, the way that these other movies do. Disney fans loved them, right? But they weren't like this crossover huge movies the way that, you know, Aladdin. Yeah. Mulan did very well, but not the same way as these other movies did.
And I can argue with that too a little bit. It's the first one of these musicals that doesn't like feature on an animal or like a mythic creature. Mulan is about a person.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, she had a dragon.
Eddie Murphy.
Right? I get what you're saying. It's maybe not the main focus.
Right.
I just think when we talk about it today, it's so interesting because Lion King, Aladdin, Beauty and the Beast, Little Mermaid, they all get thrown around more often, but Mulan, I don't hear as much, and that was such a staple.
Do you know what, like, the flip for me, though, is Mulan is probably the one I'm most looking forward to of these
because
ones.
Of that.
Because it's a live action.
And you're going to get an epic scale from it, for correct. Sure.
Well, in terms of bringing something to live action, Mulan is perfect for that. Right. I mean, that's, like, the made-for-live-action movie.
You know what I also realized that they're not doing anymore, and I think it's a lot because of that Arthur movie? And the Aladdin trailers? I haven't seen Guy Ritchie's name once. Have you?
No.
I haven't seen his name once. Huh.
I wonder what they're thinking.
They were pushing his name big, and then Arthur came out, and people thought he was going to get fired off that movie. I did, and you haven't even seen once from the director of Sherlock Holmes. You haven't seen any of that. You just seen Aladdin. They're just building off the Aladdin fan base, and they're not even acknowledging him.
I think you're dead accurate about why,
right? Yes, Arthur.
It wasn't good.
Do we have any? Is there any Pocahontas talk?
I don't know.
I do like the Colors of the Wind.
I think that will be a tough one to make live action.
Yeah.
I think there's some things they would have to figure out.
John Smith in general, all that stuff. But I mean, they did that.
They're probably staying away from that for a while.
Stay away from it.
Yeah.
They're like, we'll get to it when we have to. Yeah.
But Roxy and everybody, huge Mulan fans in the chat right now. Yeah. And I understand everybody's yelling at me because I didn't mention it, but Reflections is the other song in Mulan that I love.
Yeah.
Because it's Lea Salonga. I had a big musical phase.
You know what I love? I'm just saying. Generation also. I mean, you're an animated guy. You watched everything.
But Roxy comes from,
exactly. I think that when Roxy was growing up, that movie for sure. Sure. Totally. You and I were past the Disney stage at that thing, too. That's another reason why.
Snow White, I remember when I saw it, I liked it, but I was like, oh, that story, even as a kid, I was like, it's a little more dated. Mulan was like, look at this chick. Right. She's killing it.
And I think because it was like all my cousins that were my age or a little bit younger all had, you know, like the Disney VHSs that didn't fit in the shelf because they were those big white cases, right? And they watched Mulan, but everybody was always like, let's watch Lion King, let's watch Little Mermaid, whatever. Mulan didn't come on because we were older for it. So we didn't, you know what I mean? We were getting closer to the DVD age. We were getting to that Toy Story animation, right, little right. stuff. It just it wasn't in my zeitgeist. And again, had there been a song that came on the radio and everybody was like, "This is the Mulan song," I probably would have been more into the. It just didn't hit the radio like a lot of those other Disney
what
songs
about,
did.
What about Tarzan? Because that was huge for me. I love Tarzan because Phil Collins. That song. There were a lot of songs that hit the radio.
Yeah. He won an Oscar for it.
I dressed as her for like four Halloweens.
Yeah, they made a Broadway play out of that.
They made the Broadway play, but some of those songs, you know, be
that's why they made the Broadway play.
I can't remember. But yeah, some of his songs were hitting like top 40. You know?
Look, that was one that we showed my daughter, and we were singing those songs all weekend long.
How did you guys feel about Esmeralda?
Oh, Hunchback of Notre Dame?
Yeah.
I like that movie.
Demi Moore? Oh, yeah, that's it's fine. It's not one of my favorites.
Aren't they? I think they're making that, right?
They are doing
it. Oh, they are?
Yeah. I think so, yeah.
Just as a princess, I was wondering, how do you guys feel about Esmeralda? Did she stand out to you guys?
I don't remember enough, but they got to make Black Cauldron. Black Cauldron.
Interesting.
They should, because it's the people think it's probably the worst Disney movie.
I feel
that
like you've pitched this a couple times. Black Cauldron. Yeah, yeah.
I think to do a fantasy movie on the Black Cauldron would be really cool.
I know it.
It's great. Yeah, I loved it. And it was because I liked all that fantasy stuff back then. And I still do.
Yeah.
And I just think that you could do to be able to do a fantasy film on the Disney side of things would be really cool.
Yeah.
To do. So
when's Lady and the Tramp?
It's Disney Plus.
Oh.
Yeah, I think it comes at the end of this year.
This is when I like the chat. Everybody's putting in fun Disney movies here. Fox and the Hound. That was huge.
That would
for
make
me.
It do that.
That one would be great to see live action.
Yeah. That could also kind of be a Disney Plus, maybe.
Would you have Corey Feldman come back and do the voice?
Yeah.
Did he originally do Fox and the Hound?
Yeah, he was a kid. He was like seven.
He was
or
Todd,
eight.
Right? He was the fox? Or was he Copper?
He was the fox. No.
Was he Copper?
I'm a hound dog. He was the dog.
He was Copper.
He was
the
dog. Yeah. Huh. Yeah, he was
Fox and the Hound.
The more you know.
I enjoyed that.
It's true.
Any other interesting suggestions in there? It's like hard to even remember all of
Black Cauldron.
Hercules
is great.
Oh, I loved Meg.
Oliver and Company.
Well, the point is that they have a lot of what they can still do, for sure. Robin Hood, man, with the fox.
Robin Hood with the fox.
The best Robin Hood ever made is the animated fox.
I'm not going to disagree with
that. It's great. It's so great.
I'm not going to disagree with that. I love that.
I watched that so many times.
Robin Hood and Little John running through the forest. Hoodalali, hoodalali, hollywood a day. I love that. I used to do that. I used to remember that movie. Was that 80? Was that 1980?
It was right around
Had to have been 80.
Yeah.
Maybe 81.
To make at risk of making myself sound like an old grandma here, they just don't make movies like this anymore.
Yeah.
I feel.
Yeah, that's the truth. I think every generation will say that.
Every time a movie comes on,
my wife says, "Oh, it's no Pretty Woman."
Yeah. But it's just when I think about these movies that just moved everything. Then I think about the animated movies that I'm seeing today that are still great.
There's some really great ones.
But I don't know.
It's different. I mean, look, the same. And there's a
Lion
seven.
King?
There's a seven-year-old kid that just saw Wreck-It Ralph for the first time yesterday, right? Mm-hmm. And in 15, 20 years from now, we'll say, "I just don't make movies like Wreck-It Ralph."
Yeah.
It's same thing with our parents have seen movies.
Dude, do you know how far off we were?
By
1973.
What? Wow.
What year did you guess?
80.
As you started to say that, I was like, it's funny, because as you start to say far off, I'm like, wait a minute, that movie was the 70s.
Yeah.
And then I was so
wrong. You have to guess if it would win an Oscar, though.
Well, it's funny that you bring that up. The Lion King. If The Lion King was nominated for anything, this is going to go into the conversation. Now, it won't be because they don't want to get into this confusing conversation. Would it be nominated as a live-action film, or would it be nominated as an animated film? That's the question.
I think it would have to be nominated as live action.
I don't know, man. I'm happy to see it first, I think.
because it's not getting nominated as live action. You can be animated and nominated for Best Picture.
Yeah, I don't know.
Do you get what I'm saying? It's not Best Live Action Movie.
Well, that's
Best
right.
Picture.
You're right. You could still be nominated even if it is an
animated
film.
You would have. I don't think it gets nominated for animated.
Right. No. It's not an animated because it's not an animated film. That's the whole point.
Hearing the beast in my ear right now, and I want him out.
Let me.
Well, technically.
We could not have, and you guys will, I'm sure, hear, but we could not have disagreed harder last night on a movie we went and screened.
When are you allowed to talk about it?
At 3 p.m. today.
Okay, because I saw his tweet. He said that there was a movie that he absolutely loved, that he knew other critics were going to hate it, but he loved it. Bibiani.
Oh,
of course.
I could not get over his reaction. You know when.
Well, it's kind of like when Mark called us pitch perfect cinema.
No, I thought that was Perry.
No, Mark Ellis's tweet, my really good buddy, I couldn't have disagreed with more on a person about a movie than Mark saying that Us was perfect cinema. No.
I did love it.
note for note perfection.
And again, I'm not saying too much. I'm just describing a situation that happened inside a theater. There was a lot of laughter.
But not laughter the way you were supposed to?
I believed it was very non-intentional laughter, and he didn't. We had such different movie-going experiences because I thought I was on the same page as everybody. I was cracking up.
Because it was so stupid.
Yeah. And he was cracking up and thinking everybody else was cracking up because they were so into it. So it was interesting walking out.
What would you get from the majority of people besides him?
Me.
Yeah, they were on your side.
Yeah, for sure. Wow. But I only talked to a few afterwards. But yes, definitely. But it was interesting because he was thinking we were all in the same boat, and I was thinking we were all.
Yeah,
he's
got very. Hellboy, DC, Marvel. What is it?
No, it's not Image. Is it? What is it?
Dark Horse.
It's Bibbiani is he? That's what I.
But I'm not saying that's what we were talking about. But if we were talking about that movie, yeah.
But Bibbs likes what he likes. I mean, I know he was right. Venom. He really liked Venom.
This is what I respect about him. I agree with him on movies hardly ever. But yeah. I don't think that he's ever that guy that just likes things
to be against the grain.
He just has
a very different taste in films. It's just not mine. He and I are on the opposite sides 9 out of 10 times.
By the way, I'm like that with a lot of people too. I'm on the opposite side very frequently. Yes. You guys know I love some movies that other people think are stinkers, so I respect the heck out of his decision. It was just interesting about the experience that he was feeling one thing.
Well, we can't talk about it tomorrow because we're not here. But
cool. Question for you.
Yes.
Here's a little Schmodown question. Can you name one of the actors or actresses that were voices in Robin Hood, the animated movie with a fox?
I can tell you that
the guy. 73?
All I'll tell you is this. The same guy who played Little John voiced Baloo the bear in Jungle Book. That's all.
Is that true?
That's true. That I can tell you.
Okay, let me see.
Isn't one of the voices.
Did you just look at my phone?
No, I didn't.
No, the same one who played Little John played, because I know that I can hear the voice in my head.
You,
it's the
sir,
same exact
it's a
voice.
Classic are correct. Actor. Yeah.
Same. Wait, what did you say?
Little John was the same actor who played
Baloo.
I think, I don't know who he did, but I want to say Peter Ustinov is in it. Is that?
Wow, Mark Riley. Peter Ustinov played Prince John, a.k.a. Nice. A Lion King Richard.
I just, but that's the only name I knew and that came to mind.
The gentleman's
name.
Baloo?
I have no idea who he played.
His name is Phil Harris. Weirdly enough, in his headshot, he unfortunately passed away at the age of 94 in 1995. Yeah. Looks like Phil Hartman.
Yeah. Alms for the poor.
Yeah,
We got Roger Miller, who played Alana Dale, the rooster. Uh-huh. Terry Thomas, Sir Hiss. Brian Bedford, Monica Evans. Again, Annie
All
Devine.
My friends.
Carol Shelley, Pat Bertram.
Sorority sister. Yeah.
Pat Bertram you'd know, and George Lindsay you'd know. Because George Lindsay played... what's his name?
This is stupid. Hold on. I just got a craving for ravioli. I don't know why.
Ravioli sounds good.
You're trying to rub the cheese in my face again, aren't you?
No, I don't want to rub cheese in your face. I just have, it's, you know, you brought up the fucking meatball before, and I started thinking about it, but then, like, man, I want a ravioli.
I mean, these people that are in these movies do all the voices for these Disney movies in the 60s and 70s.
Right.
I mean, they were all the voice talent.
Because even, it's not even just the 60s and 70s. I know that the same actress who voiced Alice in Alice in Wonderland also voiced Wendy in Peter Pan.
Yeah.
And again, I know it because it's so recognizable.
You can hear
between
it.
The two of them, for sure.
It's interesting.
But, yeah.
I don't have that.
You can't pick it up?
I don't have that at all. I have it with musicians. Like, I can, if I don't know the song, I can tell. Yeah, but with actors, VO, no.
I just know the characters so well. That's probably why.
I don't have that.
I used to love that game where you'd be watching or listening to an animated movie, like, what's that voice? Before we had the internet. And then the family would start yelling at each other about trying to guess it or what was he in? Who was that?
Oh, yeah, it's not even necessarily just with animated. It's a lot of characters actors, too,
yeah,
for sure.
Totally.
I want to move on to get some phone calls and tweets from the fans because, again, this is our last show. I just got an update from.
Josh still has a show tomorrow.
Yeah.
What? No, it's our last show.
Yeah, I know. I just still want them to tune in for Josh.
Of course. And we're going to plug all that because Sinead's coming on tomorrow. I think it's just going to be you and Sinead because I don't think Brett's going to be here.
I've got a couple ideas for people to bring in for certain parts.
I'm going to send you somebody random.
Okay.
All right.
See how you play.
But okay. So that, and then Friday we're off, obviously, because we're going to be at Star Wars Celebration. But, and I just got an update from my events coordinator, Jonathan, who's the best, by the way. There's only 13 tickets left now for Chicago. It's going to be gone. By
so what will that make? 900 and
I think it's like 960 or something. Right
it's
now.
Insane.
It's insane.
It's 1,000 people.
It's going to be insane. So if you want to get those last tickets to schmodownlive.com, I cannot guarantee that they're going to be available on Saturday. So it's not, you can't just show up on Saturday. I'm pretty sure they're going to be sold out by then at this pace. So just to let you know.
You can try.
Yeah. But I want to get people to call in. All right, we got somebody. Thank you, Cody. Hey, you're in Collider Live. Who do we got?
Hey, guys. This is James from Chicago. How's it going?
What's up, man? Yeah. Are we going to see it all this weekend or what?
I will be out of town, so I'm not going to be able to make it. But I wish, man. I really wish I could make it to the Schmodown, and I really wish I could make it to the Star Wars Celebration. I'm a huge Star Wars fan. But I'm not going to be able to. I'm sorry, guys.
All good, man. Hey, enjoy your time out of town. What do you got for us today?
You know, so you guys were talking about Star Wars earlier, and I kind of want to go back to the excitement everyone's seeing for Episode 9. But we were disappointed by Episode. A lot of fans were disappointed by Episode 8, just because they kind of overcrafted the script a little too much. It was a little too over-engineered. How do you guys feel about the guy from Blade Runner making Dune pretty soon, in the next couple of years, I think? And I hear it's going to be more of a adult Star Wars theme. What do you guys think about that?
I'm going to let Riley talk on this because he's been very, very excited about this. You didn't like the version in 82, right?
It's fine.
You're talking
it's
about Lynch. Dune.
Yes, yeah. David Lynch's
Dune,
version.
The book is so good. The book is an adult Star Wars.
Yeah.
There's a huge mythology, and Denis Villeneuve, with that cast now, is going to be incredible. If it hits, if he does
Who's
it.
Who's the cast again?
We got Gosling? Josh Brolin. We have Timothy Chalamet. Okay. We got Rebecca Ferguson. We got who else?
It's
the
cast already.
It's like a running Batista, joke about how many people keep getting announced in that movie.
Yeah.
How many movies are they doing?
They're doing one, but okay. I think he said that they're looking at it as a franchise.
I'm excited for it. I mean, look, first of all, Denis Villeneuve is one guy who is – he's one of those directors. What's next? And the fact anytime
Momoa Zendaya.
Oh, Momoa, man. Okay, that's listen, it.
If you do an adult
Isaac.
Star
Oscar
Wars,
Isaac,
I'm on board. Yeah, of course.
Javier Bardem.
Yeah.
There's so many people
I'm very excited
missing.
For this movie. So, yeah, so the answer
to
your question.
A guy who's been on this show before, who? David Dastmalchian.
Who might actually be coming in again.
He is coming on again.
He is coming in again.
So back.
We should talk to him about Dune for sure. Yeah. All right, thank you for the call, my man. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course. Take care, guys.
Yeah. Yeah, man, Dune. I'm on board.
You'd like that book, man.
Yeah,
you got to read it.
I should check it out for sure.
I feel happy about the fact that I'm not as big of a fan as Riley because this really can't let me down.
Yeah,
like I'm just going in to have a good time, and I think that it
could knock you off your ass. Who knows?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But for you,
how big is the book?
The book's not that it's not like a Stephen King tome. No, I would say it's like 300, 400.
Are you asking like?
I said 7,000 pages. You went okay. Right. You didn't hear a number.
I think I was
said.
Listening.
You didn't hear a damn thing I said. 7,000 pages. All right, I can handle it.
It's 600. No, I don't know. I can't remember.
Pick up the remote.
Yeah, exactly.
I'll read it on the.
I know. I'm wondering how long the Audible would be if I was listening to Dune.
That's how I listened to Dune.
And they walk through the desert, and the big sandworm comes through. Yeah. But, all right. Thank you, Cody.
Yeah,
Cody's on the phone calls. Hey, you're apparently I can't say this. You are on Collider Live. You're not in Collider Live. People don't like when I say in Collider Live. So you're not in the show anymore.
You're in the show.
No, they don't like when I say that. Oh. So you're on Collider Live as well, too, motherfuckers.
Also, what's your name?
Yeah. Hello. How are you?
You scared them off.
Jared?
You there anymore? You gone?
Anthony?
Bueller?
He's gone.
Brandon?
Nope. Giving you 5 seconds.
Sarah?
Five.
Four.
Anybody?
Three.
Jessica.
Two.
Tara?
Hannah?
Hello? All right, he's gone.
Hello?
Cody, you should have pretended that you were the call at that point.
Do you think that they were confused when you said you're not in Collider? They hung up.
Maybe.
You're not in Collider.
Oh, I'm not in the show anymore. I don't want to be on the show. I want to be in the show. If I'm not in the show, I don't want to be on it. So I'm not going to be in. I'm not on it as well, too, motherfucker. And that was it.
I feel like
it's people. They analyze everything.
Oh, yeah.
Analyze everything. Do you ever notice when Kristian says as well, too? It drives me nuts. And how about the fact when he says in Collider Live, not on Collider Live?
I love when I get either like DMs or like messages on Twitter or something like that. They're like, hey, man, been noticing you've been getting a lot of hate lately, and I just want to say I'm a big fan. I'm like, where am I getting all the hate? It's not on my Twitter.
YouTube.
It's got to be YouTube, yeah. Right? But I just right. don't read the comments.
Shocker.
Shocker. Yeah.
I get that all the time, too. Or the, as you guys know, right. I used to absolutely hate you. You were the dumbest bitch in the world. Now I think you're cool.
Right. Yeah. Awesome. So, well, I meant it.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
I used to want to punch you.
All right. Thank you. All right. Hey, you're on Collider Live. Who do we have?
Hey, what's going on? This is Grady calling from Encino.
Hello, Grady.
From Encino. Right around the corner. Hey,
what's up, brother? Come over.
Yeah, no, it's true. What do you got for us today?
First of all, I just want to say what's up to Riley. I'm Laura's little brother again, just saying how you doing.
Oh, yeah. Well. Hey, how are you doing, Grady? Yeah. Good to see you. Or hear you. See you, sure. Hear you.
Why not?
Great.
Okay. Thanks for the call.
He's the one
buddy.
That gave us the Schnepp.
Oh, that's head. Awesome. Yeah. Nice. I love that thing. What do you got for us today?
One thing I was just thinking about when you guys were talking about Star Wars, do you think that this latest trilogy will have a similar legacy as the original Indiana Jones trilogy, and that you have really started a solid opener, a divisive second one that doesn't really connect to anything, and then a third one that harkens back to the first movie?
It's a good question.
I think it's a great question. I think as far as that
wait
goes,
wait to play it to my soft spot there, Grady, because it's my trilogy.
Yeah, I think as far as that what? Opinion goes,
you heard me.
Yeah, you could look at it that way for sure. I think people will if you compare the two as far as films. I'm not going to say that The Last Jedi is not a well-made film. It is a well-made film. There's no doubt about it. I just don't feel it's Star Wars.
What are you taking shots at Temple of Doom? You say it's not a well-made film.
It's a goofy film. I love it, but it's goofy,
dude.
Have you watched it recently?
Yeah.
I love Temple of Doom, and I love it more than most. It's a goofy movie, and Willy is awful.
Yeah, Willy's not the best.
She's awful.
But
it's goofy, dude. It's a goofy movie. Even
and
in
dark.
Even the scene.
You go to Bangkok Palace.
Yeah, that part. That
you
part's great.
Get the stones.
I tried to watch it.
Quit while we're ahead.
Yeah, I saw
that's pretty good. That's a really good impression of the guy.
It is of the guy.
I don't know what in 2019 what we're allowed to and what we're not allowed to do.
But I watched it recently with my wife who hadn't seen it forever too, and it didn't land to her. I love the movie, but it's goofy. It's a goofy film.
Yeah.
But it's great. It's goofy.
But what do you think about the third part of that
the
question?
Third part,
monkey brains.
But,
come on.
Yeah, but it really depends
snake
on
surprise.
You know, it depends on how nine lands. You know, if nine turns out to be
that's the game of this, Kristian.
I'm playing with you. What I'm saying is,
do you think they'll be nominated?
But if nine turns out to be as well received as say to the fan base as like seven was, then I think his point is valid. And I think that could be.
Because Last Crusade is.
Can you guys get over how much talk we've had of episode 8 and 9 this episode, and how little Cody has dropped those?
I know.
I just feel like I'd be overdoing it.
But today, you're probably
like
not
every
wrong.
Every time you guys said 8 or 9, I'd be doing it.
Right. I think you'd get carpal tunnel from how many times you have to click it.
Yeah, it's not like we.
Hey, Cody, any update on the tickets for Pokemon?
Josh, they're still there. Tell you guys, we can get a whole row.
Right. Oh. Any news on the?
Did you, son of a?
I was about to do
I'm
it.
I'm hoping a
thanks
caller
for the call,
it.
Grady.
Yeah.
Is
no,
Grady still there?
I want to set this rule, by the way. I want to set
the
this
callers
rule.
Callers aren't allowed to.
Callers are not allowed. They can say it, like Cody. If a caller says it, it doesn't.
Why?
Play. It's got to be in studio. The magic happens in the studio. Oh.
The only person I will let say it over the phone.
But it won't work.
If Ben Vereen calls.
If Ben Vereen
calls into the show and he says, hey guys, here you've been talking about
Zoobly Zoo, right. He just played Ben. He didn't play it.
I'm just going to get mad right there.
Well, you brought it up. All right, let's
said it.
No, you stop
Damn
that.
It.
Stop it. But how about let's do some tweets, Riley? You got any good tweets?
Yeah,
are any motherfucking Facebook comments?
Janine the Machine coming in hot.
Yes. Yeah, baby.
I actually like this.
Props before we get to that.
Yeah, do it.
Janine the Machine wrote an article on the Schmodown website on triviasd.com on diversity inside of the Schmodown and what it's like of being right now, she really is. I mean, we have Markia is on the desk and she's a manager, but Janine is.
And Danielle's on the desk as well.
Excuse me.
If I know where you're going with this,
you do. And Janine is really our first black female competitor that we have.
Yeah.
And Markia has competed as well too, but Janine is active, plays a lot, and she wrote about her experiences and what we've been doing inside of the Schmodown and what it's like for her. And it was funny because as I was reading this article, she brought up so many fantastic points on things that I wouldn't even imagined of what she was feeling on her first match, how she thought she would be perceived inside of this league by this fan base, and what it's like, and how she's watched it grow. And it made me feel good because I've been actively trying to get a lot more people involved and represent more people. But to hear her perspective on a way that I would never know in a million years, it was phenomenal. Did you read the article?
No, I haven't read it. I definitely will, though, because she is not only one of my favorite people involved, but one of my favorite characters in the league.
Right.
I think what she's doing is awesome.
Yeah, she's got a good arc this year, too.
Oh, my God. I love her. Mm-hmm. I think she's so exactly what the league needs moving forward.
Yeah.
And this is me dropping any kind of anything right now just because I can't. As the person on Collider Live, holy crap, I think Janine is the best.
I love her.
The best energy, the best attitude, works her butt off.
She's really,
so talented.
Really nice.
She's a sweetheart.
Art. I mean, she's triple really threat good. Across the board. She can perform, art.
And she's getting dangerous in the game, too. Yeah. She's starting to get really good.
Underrated.
She also looks great as Misty Knight with that arm.
Yeah, man. Yeah. So, look, guys, go on over to TriviaSD.com. Look for Machine Mondays. It's a very important article. Read the article. Even if you're not a Schmodown fan, just go and read it, because it's to get her perspective and kind of what she goes through inside of this space and her experience. It was awesome. I loved it. Riley, so what did Janine ask?
Well, she has this question for Josh. You seem excited for the hit The Lion King. Do you consider it a musical, and where do animated films with musical numbers
solid
sit with
question.
You?
Good
question. Okay. Solid question.
So, great question, Janine. Big fan of yours. So I was thinking about this when we were talking about it. I'm like, you know, I like Little Mermaid, but some of the songs are just like, it's going a little long in the tooth.
Under the Sea?
Under the Sea's good, but like some of the other ones. Beauty and the Beast, I feel the same way. Kind of gets a little long in the tooth sometimes.
Tale as old as time?
What's that?
Tale as old as time.
That song just a little. Oof. It just drains
I'm
on
just
me.
I'm just gauging your range here.
He's a terrible human.
But. And I figured that out. The thing that's really great about Lion King is in between the songs.
It's like you when you're drunk. The Lion King.
Good pun. No rhyme, no reason.
Yes, crush that
cup.
You got it. You got it just now. Just like Joey, finally get there. Yeah. Bing.
Nailed it.
Yeah. That's me.
So I will say this. The songs actually progress the plot. Also, too, the songs are incredible and fun, but they actually do something within the movie, where a lot of times those songs are just there to be songs, right? So a lot of the animated films, yes, are musicals, and that's why they translated well to musicals on stage.
What I'm taking is that you're a big Mary Poppins guy.
Oh, God. Oh. There's no way. I mean, the thing is I think that The Lion King is the only animated movie within the Disney world as far as none of the songs are like,
right?
Like even Aladdin, they're slow songs.
So it's a musical you can get behind.
Totally.
All right, there you go. Okay, so he does answer the question. That's good. All right, let's get some phone calls in here, Cody. Thank you, Cody. Hey, thank you so much. Hey, I appreciate that. Thank you so much. You're in Collider Live. Who do we got?
It's Clay Williams from Portland.
Hello, Clay Williams from Portland. What do you got for us today, my man?
Keep Portland weird.
Going away from maybe movie discussions, I was just thinking of a random casual question.
Uh-oh.
So I went into class one time, and I'm just hanging out, working on my stuff, and this girl is sitting at my table.
Uh-oh.
And basically, well, my question is, what are some major red flags when getting to know people? Not necessarily whoever it be, just for friends or whatever. What's like the biggest red flag you've had where you're like, oh, this is probably not the best person?
Well, she tells you that her boyfriend is a big Hitler supporter. I would tell you that.
Let me ask you, what did she say to you that made you ask this question?
Yes.
Funny enough, she did not really say anything. She was on her computer, and she pulled around and she said, hey, look at this.
Laughing
maniacally. She showed me her computer and showed me a picture of her father on a mugshot.
Hmm. Oh, was she laughing or was she saying that's sad?
She was like, that's my dad.
That's my pops.
Well, she started out.
And I don't know. I barely know her.
What did he do?
I was like, oh, cool.
Not what you to do. What did the dad do?
To go to jail.
Go to the slammer.
I made sure not to ask.
Oh, you got
to
ask.
I was like, I was
trying to exit out of the conversation.
Oh man, you got to ask.
Was he currently still in prison, or was this like one of those throwback Thursdays? Like, check out my dad. He got arrested for punching a dude at a bar.
Or did she say, "Look, this is my dad. Don't date me.
Or he'll come and slice your legs.
I got the vibe he was still in prison because it seemed like she pulled up a database. But literally, I know nothing about this girl, and she just shows me a random photo.
Wait, so had you been in school together with her for a long time?
No.
She knew.
I'm gonna give you a little insight as to what I think is happening here. No, it's not. I'm answering this honestly. Okay. I think a lot of people who carry baggage like that like to lay it out on the table really fast.
Tell you right off the bat,
so that you can't use it against them. As somebody who has plenty of baggage in my past, I think that often in my more insecure moments, I'll very quickly bring it to the table so that nobody can think that I'm trying to hide anything or that they can take a shot at me. And so I think that while she came off too strong and while it wasn't appropriate to do what she did, I wouldn't write her off as a person just yet because I think it was a defense mechanism. And so maybe she's looking for a friend. Maybe she wants to get to know you more. Maybe that was the best thing she could think of. She might have gone home and kicked herself and been like, that was so stupid. Why did I do that? So maybe give her a shot. I don't think it's a red flag.
Dr. Drew.
Oh, no, yeah. I've seen her. This happened a little while ago, too. And she's extremely nice. And we do have conversations. Mm. It was just something where I was like...
Very open, very fast.
It wasn't fully appropriate.
Honesty, I love. I have baggage just like everyone else. And I'll bring that shit on the table. I don't care. But the mug shot was just something where it just was so...
What kind of mug shot was it? Was it like a Nick Nolte mug shot?
Was it like tough, or did he look like he was kind of like having a good time?
If he looked like an actor in a movie, what actor would you have cast him in?
God.
Would he be a Fast and the Furious villain?
Yeah.
A Fast and Furious.
It wasn't bloodshot eyes. It didn't look like a DUI.
Right.
So it wasn't probably like a Nick Nolte, like, I've been... drunk for I've been on a 7-day bender.
Right. Did he look like crack some skulls? Like,
yeah, he looked kind of like, oh, I'm here now. That's okay. That's again. That's it just didn't.
They got
like, right. This happened. But, all right.
Don't worry, my boy's gonna bail me out.
Here's an even more important question because you were asking about red flags. How clean was her computer? Did it look like she hadn't cleaned it in a while? Because I am very.
Did it look like the computer was stolen?
Yeah. Could it have been stolen?
Did her father steal the computer?
That's a fantastic question. I did not notice.
See?
Look at
computer cleanliness, because that can be a red flag.
Oh, crap. I have a really dirty computer.
Yeah.
Unrelated to this, but related to mugshots, do you guys remember that really hot guy's mugshot that stormed the internet?
Oh, no.
And now he's married to some like A-list celebrity or something. Really? I saw this the other day randomly. You know who I'm talking about, Kristian?
No, not at all.
If you type in like hot guy mugshot, this guy got legitimately famous. He's a millionaire now because he took a mugshot that like women were like, oh my.
As opposed to Nick Nolte's.
And he committed like crimes. Like straight up, not great, dude.
I think he was in a gang. They get
he had that teardrop, the whole thing.
Yeah. All right, let's. Thank you for the phone call.
It was a great call. We can go on about red flags for days.
Good luck to you.
Thanks.
Hope that helps.
Good work, Clay.
Yeah. Riley, give me either a tweet or a Facebook.
My boy Matthew Kearns, because we were talking about Denis Villeneuve. Will we ever get a sequel to Blade Runner 2049?
No. It didn't do well enough.
That's such a bummer.
They spent too much money on that movie, and it ate poop.
So good.
Yeah, I liked it a lot.
I liked it a lot, too.
It's good. So good.
The problem with both of those movies is they don't reach the mass appeal.
You're right, because when the first movie, what is it, $20, $30 million to make, whatever it was back in 82,
sure.
This movie cost over $200 million to make, and they didn't even let this thing out, plus marketing, and it...
They broke the bank on it.
Big time.
Did they not make money?
Not really, no, because they didn't even release all of what they really spent on it. Like, Alcon dumped a lot of money into a lot of bad movies.
This movie.
I love when Tom's like,
Tom's calling.
What do you expect? Come on. You got one guy over there making decisions.
I love the
decision to make.
When we went to the Point Break screening and I walked out, he's like, what do you think? It's a piece of crap.
He got into a big art.
Yeah. What do you think? It was a piece of crap.
He was part of the company. It was a much longer story.
Yeah.
But he was calling, because another one, Point Break, they dumped so much money into that movie. They had no stars in it whatsoever.
He was working on Point Break?
Tom worked on at the company, so he worked on all the movies that were coming out at that time. But he was there
when he
was
took
there,
your job.
Yeah, he was there during like Blindside. He was during all that That's stuff. A great like, movie. Blindside's well, the reason I got all their money.
Yeah,
like they made a lot of money, but then they just kind of didn't capitalize on it. They made a lot of bad investments afterwards. Like they really ate shit from a lot of the stuff that they made.
A lot of that was Point Break, and then Blade Runner kind of
didn't help.
Yikes!
I haven't seen Point Break. Help.
I mean, Blade Runner is for like a film purist, because I know when I talk to somebody and they're like, "Oh my God, Blade Runner is one of my favorite movies." I'm like, all right, you're one of those. Mm-hmm. I get it, and I'm not gonna like, you know, make fun of you, but it's definitely not for the common movie going fan.
You like
sequel?
Like
no, the sequel too, because look, RB3, our buddy RB3, who's a huge Blade Runner fan, hates the sequel.
Okay.
Oh, he hates it. He hates it.
Oh, I thought I was in the majority.
I'm with you. Oh. I'm with you. I liked it a lot. I liked it a lot. But
I couldn't really get through it. I kept trying to watch it and get through like an hour 15 and being like, blah.
Yeah. All right, let's do one more call. Thank you so much, Cody. I appreciate it. I said I appreciate it. So
what does he want from me?
I don't know.
Jesus.
Enough is enough. Okay. You want to fade it down, I can still hear it. Thank you. Hey, you're in Colorado Live. Who do we got? Stop that.
My God.
Hello, you're in class.
How you doing? My name is Andres.
Hello.
I used to be from Covina, now from back in my hometown of Rialto. I had one appearance on the Schmodown show.
Huh. Well, you
back
had
when you took a break, Christian.
You mean the Schmoes No Show?
Yes.
Oh, Schmoes No Show. Okay.
I don't know why I mixed that up.
That's okay. I was like, wait a minute, you've competed? And I don't know? It's like when you took a break. So I've never taken a break from the Schmodown. So
I'm very excited from being commissioned. To call because, first of all, Cody, I called like 10 minutes before you even started accepting phone calls, and I'm barely getting in.
Well, you know, there's a lot of you.
So F you, Cody.
Yeah.
You know, thanks for the call here, Andres.
Yeah. So what do you got, Andres?
Well, it was actually something I wanted to say towards Ken, since I really never see him. Back when I was on that show, I said something to him, and I wanted to apologize.
Uh-oh, what'd you say?
So if you guys could extend the apology.
You could just listen to the afternoons and call into the Anchored app, and you can leave us a message for Ken or myself.
What did you say to him on the show?
I made a small joke after calling Mark a tool that,
Jesus, you were really going for it.
I just made a little joke that said no one looks up to him. Oh. And I think at that time he was kind of going through something, so I felt a little bad after I said that joke.
I'm sure he's still pissed
I think
about
that
it.
Even if somebody is not going through something, it's not a nice thing to say to somebody, and it's important to keep in mind, and I'm glad you're calling to apologize, but we joke around with each other because we see each other every day, but there's nothing that bothers me more than when somebody comes up to me and says something like that.
Like the cracker joke?
Because it's not funny.
And because you don't know that
and
person.
Don't
you
know
if they're telling you seriously or not.
So
right.
I'm glad that hopefully you're apologizing because you learned from it and you don't act like that anymore. Even with calling Mark a tool, it's not nice.
Right.
It's not nice.
Well, I didn't call Mark a tool. He said, "What's your favorite tool?" And I just answered him, Mark Ellis.
Oh.
Well,
so
kind of
is calling him a tool.
Kind of is. All right, but so the comment to Ken, it's out there now, and I'll make sure that he listens to it.
Again, you can also call the Anchor app on the afternoons, and you can tell him you're sorry.
Well, what do you want to leave us with here, Andres?
What I want to leave is I had a bone to pick with. Crap, why am I freaking out all of a sudden?
Macuga?
Yeah, it's just
Macuga,
yes.
Macuga of all people.
That's usually how it goes.
I love the guy. And he said that Mulan didn't have a song that stuck. And I was in shock when I was like, excuse me. And then Roxy backed it up when she said, Make a Man Out of You.
Yeah.
That's like the biggest song I've ever heard. A lot of people sing it nowadays. I mean, I'm 24, so maybe it's because I'm younger. And then I've even heard it, random people sing it at a bar for karaoke.
Nice. Yeah. I think that thank you for the call. I think that just goes back to what we were saying before.
Age,
it just passed. It passed you.
Yep.
Yeah, it just passed
you. It depends where it lands, yeah.
True.
I really hope that people take a lesson from that, though. Because, like, I'm sure that eats at him.
To watch the afternoons? Listen to the afternoons?
I'm sure it eats at him that he mistreated somebody that, like, he likes. And it's just not nice. I don't know how to phrase. But people all the time, they think they're just joshing. Just yoshing. And
Yosh.
Like, to call him a tool or to say nobody looks up to you when he's dedicating all his time. It's just, it irks me.
Well, it's also sometimes when people they want to be part of the joke. And they want to be part of it. And they
know.
Just, and not everybody, it's the same thing. Like I tell Rocco this all the time. Not everybody can do comedy. And so, thank you so much.
I got it.
I want your ass, and I want it now.
But the point is, sometimes you just got to think. But look, we want you to think about what the hell you're going to do this weekend. Are you going to come to Chicago? Are you going to be in Chicago for Star Wars Celebration? Come to the panel that we have on Friday. It is the Fatal 5-Way to determine who's playing Alex Damon on Saturday night at the sold-out. It will be the Athenaeum Theater, April 13th. 8 p.m. Go to the Mark Ellis Comedy Show if you can. Well, it's sold out, but you can do you can also do live streaming for the Schmodown, theschmodownlive.com. Josh McCougar will be here tomorrow with Sinead DeFries, and then he will be there telling some yucks on Friday night. Roxy, Riley, myself, Cody, the whole damn crew will be in Chicago. We'll see you very soon. Do you have a